Whoa, welcome to Team Forest TV. We're back, we're back with another fully charged. I think it's like episode 33. The last one we had was at the start of the season, and now we're only putting out another one here at the end of the season. So, lackadaisical around here. I blame
We
Sideshow, to
like
be
to keep
honest.
them regular. If we keep them regular at one at the beginning, one at the end, one at the beginning, one at the end, it gives some nice closure to the season.
I mean, it's not like there's been nothing happening. We might recap some things, but in case you don't know who we are, I think our names are on the screen anyway, but I'm admirable. I guess I'm the dissenting voice here. We got Sideshow, captain of Perilous Gaming, finished second this season, spoiler alert. Kadis, the captain of Nerd Rage, Sunny Black, the eternal ETFDL head admin, and we got Suo doing the production here. Rest in peace, David the Wynn. The
I
main
forgot I
cap.
played for Perilous. It's like when you were introducing me there and you said Captain of Perilous, I was like, wait, what? Yeah, I do. I play.
Did you get that full tilt tattoo lasered over into a Perilous one, or?
No, it's always full tilt. I think describes us.
The main component of the show then is the ETFTL Season 23 powered by TTE Sports Awards. Sonny, it must be well over a week since the polls went out on ETFTL.org.
Yeah, I think it's been 8 days, maybe,
Were
or
you getting
nine. I
into a
don't
little bit of
know.
a panic, Sonny? It'd been more than a week. You were the only guy really trying to organize this show. No one from Team Fortress TV was pulling their finger out here. I mean, Sideshow's on a holiday, so I suppose it falls to me, but we finally managed to scramble something together. What was the turnout like for the voting? Was it a popular season, Sonny?
Think the voting, usually the votings are around like 1,000 or 1,100 votes, if I remember correctly, but this time it's been like around 800 to 900.
TF2 is dead. Oh my god. Cancel the awards, Kadis.
Supposed to speak. Yes, do that indeed.
You can speak if you want, man. Just, given a chance to act natural, be a human
Yeah,
being,
very good at that.
I know this always drags out. Luckily, though, we have fewer guests than usual here for the award show, so hopefully it'll be pretty expedient. But trying to, I guess, recap the season a little bit. Some of the storylines, I just made some quick notes here, but for me, the things I remember at least, like I know I was kind of in and out, didn't cast consistently through the season, but there was all the hype in the preseason about Planet Express, who said they didn't need to qualify for the Premiership. They were going to come in and wreck the place. They picked up Raptor on Medic. They had Perez, the new hotshot scout. And then as soon as like week one and two, things started to crumble a little bit for them. Then over the course of the season, it was like, do LEGO even care anymore? Kind of the downfall of LEGO. And DD plus five abs kind of, they made us believe, that upsets were possible in TF2, but there was still magic. And then Onkaya comes in like the Grinch and just cancels Christmas there and beats them in the playoffs. But Nerd Rage going strength to strength, and so are Perilous, I think, as well, but just it wasn't enough for the final. Then we had like a bad note right at the end of the season with Sill's interview post-finals. That was, I don't know,
It
PJ
was
Sill.
delicious salt. His finest. And the rest of the full tilt squad.
So, Sonny Black, how much did Nerd Rage win then for finishing first?
500 euros.
And are they ever likely to see that money?
Look really forward
I
to December
managed to pay
2017 to
out
get that.
everything we owed to the teams from the past. Right now, I'm just waiting for the next money to come in. It should hopefully be in a week or two.
Fully
Thanks, man.
going along the same lines as all of the news programs tonight, just aggressively interrogating people over the flow of money.
Was actually talking to Campo in Gamers Assembly, and he said he didn't know anything about ETFTL sponsorship, Sonny. What's the truth?
I have a contract, so I don't know. I
No.
have a piece of paper saying otherwise.
I'm pulling your leg, chat, please. And this actually gets people really mad, so I don't want to go into that. Saito, did you ever pay the DreamHack money?
Yeah, I paid out all the DreamHack money, apart from Zebesite or somebody. No, it's like some player that I owe, like, I don't know, 50 quid or something to. Oh, no, and the Lego guys still owe me money, but yeah, in terms of paying it out, I think it's only Zebo that's left. I still have to hunt him down. You know, he disappeared from the scene. That's what you get, you know. But yeah, I still need to get onto that.
He's making fat stacks in Overwatch now. You know, he doesn't need your money anymore.
Maybe. Yeah, he doesn't need it. I'll keep it.
So, did I miss anything then with regards to Season 23? Was there anything that stood out for you that, you know, made the season or was an interesting storyline there, Kiedis?
I don't know. Like, thinking back on it, I think you pretty much summed it up. I think the DD plus 5 abs, like, failure in the playoffs is the thing that sticks out to me. I kind of had a lot higher hopes for them in the end, and publicly I'm always going to get wrecked in semis, so...
I don't know. I think it was just a season of, like, it was like an intermittent season where, like, all the teams from, like, 3rd to 8th kind of had to get their shit together. And I think more of them will be in a better position next season to actually make a challenge. I think it's just one of those seasons where kind of everyone had to scramble to get sorted in time. And then, yeah, by, what is it, 24? By season 24, they should be hopefully competing.
Yeah, something just that is that it doesn't seem like these previous... A lot of mixed teams run together and then they disband straight afterwards. A lot of these teams, I think because it was so competitive and because, I don't know, they just seem to have formed little groups that want to carry on as well. I don't think we're going to see as big a shuffle, although we might still see some teams shuffling around, but I know like quite a few of the teams are going to be sticking together and actually trying to build on it. Maybe because a lot of them had that chance at the playoffs, chance at the 3rd or 4th place spot pretty easily. So it's given them some motivation to carry on and improve, which a lot of them will do, I think.
One of the actual interesting things was the return of Team Infused as a sponsor, at least, like maybe not living up to past glories, but as well, like Skeege putting together that team with some, you know, kind of raw talent there, players like Tiger, Quick getting a break there, and Adiski, sorry, as well. Denny and Hank, garbage, but getting a shot at the Premiership.
I don't want to show off what you're saying, but I've just happened to open the tables and they're currently labelled as Me Gusta. So,
Oh, wow.
Maybe, that's a short-lived dream.
That was a nice, brief moment in the sun then for Team Infused.
Well, yeah, the other team that faded into mediocrity towards the end of the season was Force Kings. They started out fairly decently. They were getting some pretty good results and they looked like they were potentially going to finish somewhere around the middle of the table.
Mediocrity is being a bit kind, to be fair.
Yeah, definitely. They faded into absolute abject misery. They slumped towards the end. I think of like they just lost motivation halfway through the season. Some of them had to go to...
Saicho, you breaking up?
You're lagging like a motherfucker.
No.
You need to transmit on Mumble, Sancho. We've lost you on Mumble, but we see your mouth moving on Skype. Yeah, let's just continue on here. Hopefully, Sancho gets a reprieve there from French internet hell. Sancho, you back in Mumble?
I am back in Mumble, yes.
You were just telling us about Force Kings, and then you kind of froze up on us.
Yeah, and I think I've gone from Skype as well. But yeah, just saying how Force Kings just faded towards the end of the season. It's always the same with all Israeli teams, I think. They lose a few players to train in the army, or some of them lose motivation and they just collapse. But I thought at the beginning of the season, you know, they had the motivation, they were actually playing at a decent level. And they just they let it slip. But I don't think that was, you know, a fair representation of how they would have gone had they not had those kind of personal problems. They looked like a pretty promising team.
Yeah, but it's kind of like a season of two halves for them. They really did seem to throw at the end of the season, but like they always knew that Jackie Legs, their caller, was going to be going pretty much immediately after the season was over, so perhaps, I don't know, they're always going to be good friends anyway. That was an interesting part of their storyline, but like I expected them to make playoffs. I thought they were going to be a great dark horse, but it was actually DD plus 5 abs, 5 friends, whatever, who surprised us. At the end of the season, we've had the high playoffs. Bags are 5 have made it into Premiership next season. And Backget Foolery, who we saw at Gamers Assembly, playing under the name Caribou.tf. Similar team, more or less the same roster. are probably going to go Prem or get a chance. I don't know. Sonny Black will be the man with his, who decides their fate, I guess. Is that right, Sonny? Do they get automatic promotion if Infused, sorry, Megusta don't want to play them?
That's something we are still discussing. If they just get, like, they probably won't get a direct spot into Prem, but they will definitely have a guaranteed spot in the playoffs. But that's still something that's being discussed.
Who are you discussing with, Sonny Black? We know you're the only Pyxis admin. Are you asking those Highlander nerds again? Do you not remember what they did to you over Coal Plant at the start of the season?
He sits in the shower, comes out, and as he's brushing his hair in the mirror, he just has a discussion with himself. He just says, should we let them into playoffs? Should we just give them straight into ETFOL? And then it's like the Gollum. He's a man of two halves. One half really likes the Russians and wants to give them a straight spot in and kick teams out. He goes to get out of here. Terrible. But the other half, you know, he wants playoffs next season.
I think there's a lot of teams interested in forming next season. Like, I was just playing TFT Pickup today for the first time in a while. I was talking to Nation. He says Ramagan's coming back with the team. We were talking to French teams at LAN who seem to want to continue to get better. Nation himself is talking about putting some sort of team together with, like, he mentioned Ryder, Condom. Can't even remember who else, but, you know, a team that could at least be in the qualifiers for Premiership or whatever. If not in Prem itself.
Condom, have I missed something? Have Lego died
Apparently he's
in the off season?
hedging his bets. He wants to try both things here.
Fair enough. Maybe that's news to Josh.
They wanted
He's gonna
Nation, I
send
think, into
around the.
Lego because apparently Demul is gone from Lego.
Yeah, I heard that. Also, top five as well, which I guess you were
Oh
alluding to
yeah.
when you were talking about French teams. But top five are confirmed to be reforming with Medico leaving Publiclear. But I believe the rest of the Publiclear is carrying on unless that's changed while I've been away exploring. La Belle France.
Yeah, so it was potentially as well, or the gossip that broke at LAN was that not just Medico was going, but Flip as well was potentially going to join them. Maybe Demul on demo as well. We heard they were looking for a demo. I don't know about that one though. But anyway, we've talked a little bit about what's happened, potentially what's coming up. Sonny Black, you know what time it is. It's time for the awards, baby. I'm gonna whip open the news post and we'll get the most obvious one out of the way, I suppose, first. I'm starting at the top here. We're just gonna go from top to bottom, Sonny Black. And once again, you know, remind everybody, Cadis is here, repping Nerd Rage. We've got Saijo from Perilous. There's some bias here, so I have to try and stir things up, I think. Sonny Black, I hope to hear some strong opinions from you for once as well. But first award then is going to be Demo Man of the Season. Tell me all the nominees who actually made it into the vote as well.
The two in the poll are also the only two that got nominated. So out of 27 nominations, Kate has got 24 and Spud got 3.
Only 27 people made nominations, so out of like 8 times 6 players in the Premiership, only 27 could be bothered to send in their nominations.
And maybe they thought they'd abstain because
Yeah, I think it was
they.
28, but Cadis couldn't vote for himself, so he didn't vote.
That's kind of awkward, isn't it? I made a pact with myself this year. Normally, I try to be really impartial with who I nominate, but then I always let bias slip in. So this season, I just decided to say fuck that and just be entirely biased the entire way, because it always happens anyway. But I have this pretense that I'm not being like completely biased. Yeah, I just threw that out the window this time.
Who did you nominate? Nobody.
Oh yeah, no one. I didn't nominate anyone unless I could nominate a teammate.
Brilliant.
It's
What
pretty
did you think?
pathetic.
Like, you guys weren't going to win the awards after you, like, steamrolled the season?
I don't know. I think I was at work when I got them, and I was like, I was bored at work, but then I just decided to just, I couldn't be bothered to think about it, basically. I was like, on my
You were
phone.
bored, but you wanted it to be over as soon as
Yeah.
possible.
I
Any
was like,
distraction from your work?
I don't really
No.
like using my phone for that kind of stuff. So it's like you start, it's like, yeah, I'm really bored. This sounds like a good way to kill some time. But then it's like typing on my phone. It's like this sucks. I can't be bothered. So yeah. Really gave it my all this time.
Well,
Glad to have you with us.
who did you nominate, Saito?
I think I nominated Cadus as well, although frankly I can't really remember my nominations. They happened quite a while back and I didn't make note of them, but I believe I nominated Cadus. I think he was pretty much head and shoulders above all the other demo men. Even Spud, when we were playing against them, you know, just like scrimming or whatever, it'd be fine, but in the actual games, Spud was, not to be talking shit about my team or anything, but most of our team just got blown out the water, and Spud wasn't really an exception to that.
Spud got the three votes, or the three nominations he got, none of which came from his team.
But you can't nominate your teammates, or you can?
No, you can. I'll put that down to our team being unbiased, rather than us all just thinking the Spud's shit, because we don't actually think Spud is bad.
No, but if Spud got one nomination less, or if Cadus got one nomination more, I would have just given the award to Cadus, because then he would have crossed the 90% of nominations again, I think.
We should really be able to nominate, like, more than one person and just kind of like wait it. So like say someone wanted to nominate three demos or whatever, they could like put whoever they want as number one and get like, you know, like 3 points toward that, and then number two gets 2 points and number three gets 1 point. Then you actually get like a variety of people in getting like points. You could actually have like multiple people in these kind of polls.
I remember having this conversation before.
Yeah. Yeah. Always come up with that at the award show. Not before the
and you
the
never remember
this is before the
you
next
should have
awards.
Your fucking notepad and pen out on you,
like I say
the last award show happened so long ago, it's like there's no period of time in between.
It's like fucking Groundhog Day, man, every season.
I don't remember there's awards until I get a message from you and it's like, here's time, I'm asking for your nominations, and I'm like, well, I'm probably like the ninth person to give you them, so you can't change the system now. So just yeah, write it down. Write it on that mirror we were referencing earlier, and maybe next time we'll have more than two people for half the polls.
I liked it better when there was at least three people in the votes, because, I don't know, like you could nominate more people. At least you could give some recognition to other people, but anyway.
Nominate more people. I don't know what you're remembering there.
I mean, whenever people would have given more nominations.
Whenever there were a wider variety of better players in Premiership, is that what you're alluding to?
I don't know if that's what I mean.
I think something we haven't talked about, though, is potential other people that you would have liked to nominate. I think it was a bit of a breakthrough season for Shappy. You wrote it a little bit in the Premiership playoff preview article that he's just been struggling to get into Prem as scout for so long. He was that close to making like some kind of bargain, negotiation to let him into some Premiership team. And then he goes on to Demoman. And he's actually been playing fairly decently. I feel like if he sticks with this for a while, he'll continue to improve. I don't think he should have been nominated for best demo of the season, but I'd throw his name in there as like a potential upcomer on demo, I think.
I would agree, yeah. He's the kind of guy who's like every season he's always asking you, like, are you making a team? Or he's always looking for that opportunity to get his break. And like, I think he's played Demoman originally before he played Scout. Maybe switched off to try and, you know, get that foothold with Scout, but then went back to Demo. But yeah, it's hard to think of any other Demoman who really had a big impact for their team. I'm excited to see Adiski in the Premiership, you know, but his team struggled to make an impact. So yeah, Sonny Black, maybe it's all right just to have two nominees. Tell me then about the voting, you know. Give us the big surprise.
Second place goes with 20.2% to Spud, and Cadus wins surprisingly with 79.8%.
What do you think about that, Marvel?
I'm shocked. I forgot to ask actually who people voted for, but I voted for Cadus, so I assume it's the same.
I think that's quite a reasonable spread. I mean, for, you know, a guy who's led his team to be a great success and performs really well in the season. In the season?
Oh, who's in reason?
No, not in reason.
Like an old man. It's time to hear a gate up, never mind.
Saicho?
Hello?
Hello?
Oh, yeah. I thought... Did you just stop talking?
Got him, Mr. English.
No, no. No, I said that I think that's a fair spread of the votes. I think that's about how it ended up playing out in the season and then in the playoffs.
Yeah. I eulogized a little bit about Kyrgios in the Premiership preview article, just saying that I felt the fact that his team had matured to this point really allowed him to play demo man more, focus more on his game this season, and he really did wreck everybody. I don't have Gentleman John's stats handy, like the sort of tables or whatever. I don't know if they still even exist, but Lee going up into the playoffs, you know, he was pretty much number one in every stat. As well as, you know, putting this team together, Colin. It's pretty incredible. You're great, Jason. You're great. Give yourself a pat on the back there.
Thanks, gang.
Let's keep it moving, Sonny Black. Who did you vote for, Sonny, actually? Tell me.
I voted Cadus.
Nice. Let's go. next award here, sponsored by Nerd Rage, is going to be Best Medic of the Season. Tell us the nominees.
Pumzilla got 14 nominations, Kors got 13 nominations, and Condom got 1 nomination.
Who voted for Condom?
I'm not sure if I should tell you that.
Please don't.
Is there a sacred oath between you and the voters?
I'm like that offshore guy. I have to keep the secrets.
Who was Sonny?
It was no one from his team, I think.
Was it Happy
Cool? Eek voted for Condom.
EQ.
EQ.
What? That's so random.
How strange. Yeah, I wouldn't have expected that at all. Oh well.
I'd just like to make the point that there's been no black nominations here so far. Sonny Black. I'm comparing the ETFTL awards to the Oscars. You know? Do you think Black Lives Matter? That's what I'm asking you, Sonny.
Like the people giving nominations, how many of those are black? That's what you should ask.
ETFTL Premiership is run by old white men, okay? We need more women, and we need more people of a diverse ethnic background. But yes, the nominees then were Permzilla, who else?
Goss
and Condom. I actually think Condom's gotten a lot better, because I used to fucking, I don't know, blow up on him in casts, but maybe that's just, you know, my bad medic bias. But I think he is... improved. He really got pooped on that game on Viaduct by DD5F, but that was kind of his team's fault. But anyway,
maybe there should be like an honorary mention for Honey as well, who did a fairly decent job of like propelling his team to clutch those upset wins and drive his team to the third place regular season finish, because he is a real driving force.
I don't think they thought so. They cut him pretty much straight away, didn't they? Did you miss that one?
I think that's more of a personality thing, though, wasn't it? Rather than it being a skill.
Who are we talking about here? Honey?
Play with.
Yeah, Honey Badger.
He didn't... Oh, who do you mean? The Feeling got cut?
No, he got cut.
Honey didn't get cut. Raptor got cut.
No. What? No, Honey Badger got cut, like, a week ago.
Did he?
Yeah.
Why? How did he get cut from his own fucking team?
I don't fucking know. I can't even remember. I heard Raptor was going to trial for them. So I'm guessing he got cut because, you know, maybe they're just getting ready
That's
for Medic Limit 2.
He was like their fucking talisman. He built that team and called them to the finals and then fucking Chappie threw the game. 2 months.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I guess he can be... He's known for being a bit toxic, to use that phrase.
He's a Brit after all, you know.
Yeah, but like, I don't know, I kind of thought the team just kind of got on with it, like, and didn't really mind. But I guess they do mind, because they're going to play.
Or maybe it wasn't, I mean, if we don't know that much about it, maybe it was something, but I find that less easy to believe than the whole personality, given that that's, like, constantly raised as a weakness of Honey Badger's, is his propensity to get annoyed at teammates that he thinks are underperforming.
Yes.
It was like a really weird situation, like for a medic to come up with like no prem experience before and call the team. Like most of the medics you see calling in the Premiership have some experience, or at least can, you know, they have a little bit of respect to their teammates, like Onkaya, or you think about like Nox in the past. But for him to come up and be able to do that was quite an achievement, and yet he doesn't get any nominations. So
was he playing with them before this season?
Yeah, they were playing in high with as two teeth T-Rex. Yeah, it was. I think there was three, maybe four of the same players.
That's kind of weird then that they cut him now, because like, I'm guessing he didn't suddenly become whatever they didn't like about him didn't suddenly happen now, and they were clearly like, you know, getting results and developing.
Yeah, and I don't feel like he was underperforming mechanically. I mean, he was never one of the best mechanical medics in Prem, but whenever you watch him, it wasn't like he was had terrible movement or was letting them down in key situations. So, yeah, perhaps a questionable decision, but I don't really know the ins and outs of the situation.
People are questioning me mentioning Onkaya and Nox in the same sentence, you know, but I stand by that. I think Onkaya is a mastermind. Once the whitelist gets removed and stuff, his Highlander experience is going to kick in, man. I've seen him in matchmaking. He's got strats. You're going to see. You're going to see Twitch chat. You'll rue this day. Come A58. But let's, I don't know, talk about who we voted for. I voted for Permzilla. And I'm just, you know, a little bit of a Permzilla fanboy. I think he is an unsung hero in the Nerd Rage roster. He does his job very well, doesn't take too many risks, and it just plays into their low-risk playstyle. It made Perilous very mad after the finals. Whenever I was like adding some comments to the preview article, I don't know why I started writing about medics, but then there was like salty comments there about why the medics are being, you know, bigged up, despite it being the worst season for medics in a long time. But I don't quite agree with that. Like, I feel there's a lot of new medic talent coming through. We talked about Honey already, but you see Permzilla still at the top after two seasons. Onkaya has returned playing better than ever. You got Koss making all the sick highlights for the Team Fortress TV YouTube channel. At least one of them anyway. Do you think the medics are worse than ever now, guys?
No, I don't think so. I think maybe if you just consider like the very top medics, then there's perhaps been a dip. I mean, there's no people you would commonly associate with that. You know, like, you've lost Nox, you've lost Miralyn, you've lost Bool, although you wouldn't really have Bool in the same kind of elite level, in my opinion.
Both those guys are, like, anomalies as well. Like, Nox's biggest asset, obviously, is a great mechanical player, but it was as a caller, and Miralyn was, like, this weird outlier who was just incredible at dodging. It's, like, is it fair to compare the current generation of medics to these two, like, gods of medicing? They were both great for different reasons.
Possibly not, but I think it's a comment made by a North American a viewer, and I do actually think that the top skill level in, or rather the top medics for North America are better than the top medics in Europe at the moment, even if the overall skill in Invite and Prem is probably slightly better in Prem, actually. But the top medics in Invite, I think, probably better than their equivalents in the top Premiership teams. But I don't think that there is an overall decline in the skill level just because a few top players leave.
Your thoughts then on the medic nominations? Oh, voice crack. Tell me, Saito, who did you vote for and why?
I voted for Koss. There was a little bit of personal bias in that, but also it's they play kind of pretty different styles. Koss plays a little bit more, a little less passive, not choosing to reserve his life in a lot of these situations. Kind of Perm plays a similar style to like Shade would have done classically, where he's playing behind his team, making sure that he gets out and stabilizes in all of those situations. And he has good movement, he has pretty decent mechanics, knows where to heal, but sometimes, like especially when you watch the VODs of Nerd Rage playing, he can seem a bit lost and requires quite a bit of guidance from the rest of his team in order to play at that kind of level, which, you know, is fine. You want to rely on your teammates. But I think as, you know, if we're judging like individual players and the level that they, what they bring to their team as well, I think it's fairly equal, to be honest. And my personal bias threw it over to Koss because he hits those godly arrows, you know.
Kiedis, you know, you want to big up your boy.
Yeah, like, I don't know about this one. It's kind of hard to say, actually, because, like Sideshow said, their roles within the teams are so different. Like, Perm literally just has to play his role as he's told to play it. And as long as he does that, then he's doing everything right, basically. Whereas, I don't know, when I watch like Perilous play, just, I don't know, they are less coordinated than we are, it seems. So it seems like naturally that just puts a bigger burden on Kost to perform at a higher level. So he kind of, just for the team to function, he kind of has to do a bit more. So I don't know, in one sense, he deserves it because of that. But then on the other side, Perm's doing his role kind of like perfect, and Kost is playing a role that you actually can't do perfectly. There's a lot more hit and miss. Like, he has these big kind of clutch moments and stuff, but like, if you think back to like the big play Kost did on Granary last this season, with like, he gets two kills, like Perm would never be in that situation, because the way we play and the way we set things up, we'd never let Perm get in that situation to begin with. Whether he's capable of pulling it off or not, I'd be furious if he was in that situation. So it's kind of hard to say. Like, I voted for Perm, but like I said, I was shamelessly biased. This is probably one of the harder ones. Like, I went with Perm, Saichi went with Kost. It's like a toss-up. I hope this is one of the close ones, so they at least both get kind of their due, because they both played good this season.
Really, what I reiterate that, actually, like, so the Kost has all these crazy moments because he ends up, or he or his teammates put themselves in these crazy situations, but it's like, just Perm is never there. He's already like a few steps ahead, so that's,
or a few steps behind. That's really the key, isn't it?
You know, last season I got mad at Primzilla. I watched him run away and let his teammates die whenever. But this season I thought he managed to tighten that up a little bit. But
I think also, like, last season they had some slightly closer competition at the top as well, just in those key matchups in the final or whatever with the other team. But I think the key point here is that all Permzilla has to dodge is the sideshow bomb. This isn't a good medic. All he has to do is step to the side and I miss all my rockets. I mean, Kost has to dodge and weave around all of these incredible players and he still puts up the same stats, you know. Give my boy some credit.
Do you think anyone could do Permzilla's job, sideshow? Like, he's got the best supporting cast around him, best pocket, best ammo.
I don't think anyone could. But I think it would be easier for somebody who bought into the role.
Any of the
to
other
play.
Premiership medics, could you just substitute them in there?
No, because they don't have the same, like, they don't buy into it in the same way. They're not happy to be like this role player and deviate from how they've been playing medic this whole time. But you could potentially pick somebody up who had like some raw mechanical skill, as they did really with Perm, and a brain, and tell them what to do, and it would be much easier for them to fill in Permzilla's role than it would be Kost's, but you couldn't just do it with anybody.
Sonny Black, is that why you picked up Permzilla as admin, just because he would do exactly what you told him?
Pretty much.
Go ahead, then. Put us out of our misery with the results.
Let's see. Second place with 49.1%.
Is it close?
And 15 votes behind the first place, Permzilla.
My Sorry, boy, man. That is so close.
There's See? Even closer one.
So the There's condom an even closer one than that.
Was yeah. Condom first place, or was it Kost, or what?
In a fluke result, Condom gets 50% of the votes and wins. Kost, somehow, after angering everybody by calling the loose cannon shit, gets no votes.
So King of Squirrels is the winner then, Sonny Black? Confirm?
Yep.
Congratulations.
King of Squirrels, now the king of ETF2L. Who can stop him?
I think he's a worthy winner, you know, having listened to both sides of the argument. Like, was favouring Permzilla, but I'm coming around to seeing Kost as the number one medic in Europe now. We might see some roster transactions happening here in the off-season. Nerd Rage. Hey,
he's moving to DD5F. We're selling him for fat stacks to DD5F. That's why they kicked Tony.
Yeah, that's a good one. These results are they're hotting up right now. You know, we knew who was going to be demo man of the season, I think, but wow, that is a surprise to me, at least. So let's keep it rolling here. I'm looking straight down the list again, Sonny Black. It's going to be Pocket Soldier of the Season. Tell us who the nominees were.
Out of the 27 nominations, Captain got 21, QNX got 3, Atlantis got 2, and Tech got 1.
Tech? Did he play the Chaos Anomaly at the start, right?
Yeah, I think he played two, or maybe even just one game with us. But it still gets...
No nominations for MGE Mike, no?
No.
Shadowburn not in the results, though. Fuck it. Okay, who did you guys nominate then? I didn't get any nominations for some reason.
Went with Captain. He was...
I actually can't remember who I nominated. Oh, go on, carry on.
I can check.
Like, Captain played probably his best season this season. And to be honest, his competition on Pocket was probably worse than every other season. Like, I think... I'm trying to think back to last season. All right, Tech won it last season, which was a ridiculous result, and he still gets a nomination this season. But like last season, it was like Syl played like a godlike season, and this season Syl was like not at that same level. He's still good, but like nowhere near that level. And Captain was like three levels above where he was last season, and even last season he was good. So yeah, nominated Captain.
Yeah, I can't remember whether my personal bias kicked in and nominated Syl, or whether I just went with Captain, because I actually completely agree with Kedis here. Syl had a really good season last season. Like, I thought that he should have won it last season, actually. But this season, he slowed down a little bit, taking a slightly different role. Or our team just seemed to be a little bit more messy anyway. And Captain, yeah, really stepped up. So that's who I went for with my vote, at least. Who did I nominate, Sonny?
You nominated Captain.
There we go. So I didn't, you know, completely unbiased.
Is that the personal bias you were talking about? You fucking hate Salenti, so you're like...
No, I think, you know, he played well, but it wasn't, he dipped a little bit and Captain got better, so.
Like, we played so many matches this season where, like, there would just be fights and we would win these fights. And I would just kind of think, like, that was super comfortable. Like, looking at what we did and what the enemy team did, I would just be like, I have no idea why that fight was so comfortable, like Viaduct mids and shit like this. And then I would check the VOD and Captain just jumps in and hits, like, four directs and does, like, 600 damage. And this was just, like, he would do this routinely, like, three times a game. Just we'd get like a team five victory and we had like no right to do it, so like we'd have like six alive, they'd have zero alive, and I was just like, I have no idea why that happened. And then it just turned out Captain was just god mode, basically.
Yeah, he really does make playing the game look easy. Maybe it's you know, the threats he's dealing with, like Sideshow, whatever, doesn't have to, you know, break a sweat there. But just watching Captain, he has continued to improve season after season. And then, like, I was talking to him before the playoffs. It's like a D-Mix or something, and I was trying to, you know, mine him and Salentes for information. I was like, Captain, do you realize that you are, like, essentially the new MGE Mike? You're the best pocket in Europe. Do you feel that way, or do you feel like you're still living in the shadow of Mike? And he was reluctant to say, you know, that he was the best, or he is, like, you know, on that same level. Do you guys think that Captain is equivalent to Mike right now?
It's a little bit more difficult than just saying yes, because even though he seems like it within Nerd Rage, Mike was able to do that within a lot of the top teams that he played for, and was also able to carry top teams even without being surrounded by like a good team structure or whatever. So perhaps a little bit too early just to put him on the same kind of godlike tier as Mike, but certainly within his team at the moment, he's playing at the same level you would expect Mike to be playing within that kind of team, I think.
You've played with Mike, Kiris.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, it's like a weird question.
We're comparing like almost different eras here, or it's...
Yeah, like, the thing is with Captain, he has a completely different personality to Mike. Like, when Mike came up from, like, I don't even know what he did before he was playing in Prem. Like, when Mike came up, he had, like, a much more, like, evident ego than Captain. Not to say that one has an ego and the other doesn't, but it was, like, a lot more evident. And kind of the way he played the game really reflected that, like, just his, like, supreme self-confidence in how he played. Whereas Captain, I feel like it took him a while. He's there now, but it took him a while to really consistently believe he's as good as he is. Like, he knows he's good, but really often he would like forget it in the heat of the game and like lose his confidence, and you wouldn't see him perform as well as he can on kind of like a regular basis, at least like I'm thinking to the start of like when we were Reason, the first season or so.
Mm-hmm.
But like that shit's like all in the past now, and now you're kind of seeing like the real Captain. And what's more is he's like adapted so much. Like when he came into Prem, or at least when he came into Reason, I don't really know about Planet Express, but when he came into Reason, you know, he was a shotgun pocket and he got accused of baiting, and him and Haffy were always fighting about how they were like Captain telling Haffy he's baiting, Haffy telling Captain he's baiting. But now Captain is just like this like perfect player basically who's...
And Haffy's still baiting.
Yeah, Haffy's still baiting. That's what you want. that's the thing it always went like. You want the scout to bait and you want the soldier to get in. And Captain always had this thing for a while where he was like maybe a bit too much thinking about stats or and things like that. But now he's just always thinking about the team, always like doing the right thing. And now he's confident enough to just hit these rockets like all the time. So I don't know. They're completely different personalities, which is, I think is what makes them different as players. So it's hard to say that he's the MG Mike, but he is the equivalent player of this era, I'd say. But I think Mike is probably something special when Captain has a way to go before he really hits the same kind of acclaim, but I think he's capable of it.
Just wanted to go off on that tangent because I was reading a little conversation between Sideshow and Midnight Mick there on the comments for this event. But let's bring it back then, Sonny Black. Tell me what the results were. All right, so who did we all vote for? And like, you told me who you nominated. I voted for Captain for the reasons mentioned.
Yeah, Captain.
Same.
Sonny? Captain. Okay, it's unanimous. Tell us the results then, Sonny Black.
19.1% go to Nex, and Captain wins with 80.9% or 671 out of 829 votes.
Yay, Captain, but we didn't even mention why the fuck was Nex in this vote. We literally didn't even mention, like, why was he there? Like, he played pretty good for, like, a third of the season that he was in.
I guess because people saw that as soon as he got into DD plus 5, they started accelerating upwards, but I know, is it you, Admirable, that attributes that quite a bit to QNX, but I think I saw it written somewhere that you were hyping up QNX and saying that this was, you know, partly due to his impact on the team, but I personally don't think it really is. I think it was a bit of a coincidence, and they both, you know, it didn't make that much difference.
Well, there was clearly problems with feeling. I don't know if I wrote anything about that in the article, but I definitely think the addition of QNX was the difference because he plays a very direct playstyle. Like, you know what you're going to get with QNX. He's the kind of teammate you want because you know he's going in and he's prepared to lead the way. Like, he's going to use his health. So, like, for Shappy and the scouts, like, I think really Ixie... what do you call the other scout in that team?
Oh, Schoberg.
And Schoberg, like, they were probably the beneficiaries of that because, you know, QNX is going in, he's doing consistent damage. You know, he mightn't be the pocket you want in a long, drawn-out game, but, like, I'm thinking back to the Virat game where they slammed Lego. Like, QNX just constantly going in, balls deep into their combo behind that little rock. Partly bad positioning from Lego, I would say, but, like, a very reliable, very consistent performer. But at the same time, I'm sad not to see Salenti's in the nominations, to be honest.
I guess I phrased my question kind of badly. It's not so much like, why is QNX here in this nomination, but why is QNX here when, like, Sil isn't and Josh isn't? Like, he played pretty decent.
Oh, yeah,
decent.
Josh as well. I completely forgot about him.
Like, he played pretty decent for sure, and he had a huge impact in turning that team around. But, I mean, the impact he had got them to, like, you know, let's not kid ourselves, their team finished fourth. And... sure, he was probably one of their better players, and they improved quite a lot when he joined, but that improvement only took them to fourth at the end of the day, and he was only there for like a third of the season. Like, consistency is a big part of like what I look for in these players, and like if you're only playing like a third of the games of everyone else, quite a lot easier to be consistent over that period. And I don't know, even though Lego kind of bombed out, it definitely wasn't Josh's fault. He was still a great player. And
whose fault was it?
What, the Lego thing?
Mm-hmm.
To be honest, I don't even remember. I can't remember who they lost to do so bad in the end. I guess DD5F,
yeah.
But I don't think I watched that game, to be honest, so it's hard to say. But I doubt it was Josh's fault. Yeah, and even so, like I said, Sil didn't play as well as he played last season, but he was still a big part of why Perilous got second.
Yeah, and that's maybe, you know, coming back to a bit of the flaws with the nomination system, is that people like didn't vote for Salentes because they felt like he was less deserving than the last time, and, you know, a lot of those votes will have gone to Captain. And then there's like a niche vote of QNX of people who think that he deserves a nomination. So, you know, obviously Salentes did deserve a spot in the nominations.
Congratulations to Captain then, and I don't know, Salentes, work on your PR campaign for next season if you want more votes, mate. Don't be so toxic.
Be fair to Sil, he actually did, like, after this, like, little shit we had in the interview, he actually did, like, message some of us and kind of pass on, like, you know, saying he was just, you know, reacting kind of in the heat of the moment. And that he actually, you know, I can't remember what he said, but he was, like, pretty cool about it afterwards, which is not something I normally would expect from someone in that situation, to actually message you and say, like, yeah, I was being a bit dumb or whatever. I don't really know what he said, but it was cool.
He actually does that, like, quite a lot. I think, like, sometimes he just gets a bit emotional and blurts out stuff, but he always comes back afterwards with a clear head.
Yeah, like, but I don't know.
The majority of these situations.
I guess I've seen him have run-ins before, like, he's had run-ins with us, and I never got any, like, kind of, like, follow-up like that, so it was pretty cool, actually. So just, you know, people were saying Sil was a dick after that, or whatever the fuck people were saying. He was cool.
The positive I took away from him was, you know, that he's passionate about the game. He wants to win. So
yeah, that was actually literally what I said about it. It was like, it was cool. It's actually cool to see people that care when they lose, rather than just being like, my monitor was off, ruffle, or whatever the fuck they normally say.
Clash, they were off. All right, let's keep it rolling here. Rumor of the season, Sonny Black, hit me with the nominations.
I'm feeling pretty tense here.
We've got a very eager father in Twitch chat, no doubt.
27 nominations.
My dad in Twitch.
Sideshow got 1. Dimul got 4.
Who voted for Sideshow?
Jackie Lex got 4. DD5F got 4. And Drag got 14.
Who nominated Sideshow?
Damn easy.
Baller.
Respect. Remember that, Sideshow, you know. Remember who your friends are.
Exactly. I'll pick him up.
So who were the top 3 there that made it into the votes?
4 made it into the votes.
Oh, the votes, sorry.
Because DD5F, Jackie Lex, and Dimul all got 4 nominations.
Frankly, I don't know who's voting for Dimul as Rumor of the Season when he had, like, an honestly quite bad season on Roma. Jackie Legs as well. I mean, you're voting for the Roma of the 8th best team in Prem, even though he played fairly well in the first half of the season and was doing really well for his team in the games that they won. I don't know how you can really justify voting for the Roma who literally finished last, but fair enough.
He was, this is the argument we always used to have over Nox, because he was like the pocket caller. Jackie Legs is the rumor caller. But I'm not, again, I'm comparing, you know, one of the all-time greats to Onkaya or Jackie Legs. But...
Jackie Legs, how the times have
But without Jackie Legs in that team, they wouldn't have made it into Prem, and they wouldn't have had a good start of the season that they had. And, like, I enjoyed watching him play this season. And hearing his interviews and stuff, so maybe that's part of the reason he got nominated. You know, likable personality. Take notes, Lindy's. Sorry, but I'm looking at my. Who did you nominate, actually, guys? Tell me who you nominated.
Drac, shamelessly biased.
Can't even remember. I think it must have been Drac.
You know, if you open up the ETF2L news page and log in, you can see who you voted for.
No, I don't think I vote for people at all.
Nominations anyway.
But yeah, nominations. I can't remember who I nominated.
Okay,
you
voted for Drag.
You nominated DD5F Sideshow.
Yes. Didn't. No, Jesus I remember. I remember this one because I knew that Drac was going to get it. So I thought the only one of the other Romas that I think deserves consideration in that is DD5F.
Are you kidding me?
No, I'm genuinely not. I think he was doing really well for his team.
Right. Only you would fucking say that.
No, well, apart from the Market Gardener retardation stuff, right? I think if for all the situations where he just went for a crazy shovel kill on somebody, he actually did a lot of work for his team.
But then he also just jumped in and died like a retard like 10 times a game with a shovel out. And he got like a kill.
Yeah, but
like,
that's like...
Every now and then he got a kill from it, which we'll remember forever because it will be in the beta movie. But I mean, this is like 10 deaths a game he has where he's just jumping in like a moron. Like he had good moments and he could easily be a really good player if he decided to apply himself. But he's just like going for these showboats like every 5 minutes per game. It's like...
Yeah, I know, but
I find it really
that's...
hard to someone give it's such someone a credit
specific...
when they do this.
I think it's such a specific criticism that he could easily just cut out of his game It's like it's one individual thing. He just happens to do it all the time. But it's not like saying somebody has bad aim or someone has
Sancho's a great player, but if he just didn't dribble all the time, he'd be great.
Yeah, but dribbling is like a vast swathe of problems that you've grouped into one thing. Whipping your Market Gardener out is literally one problem. Like it's not a collection of problems about his play style or whatever.
It's kind of happening way too often though. And there's also one other problem where he camps forward spawn and faces the wrong way in playoffs.
Oh god, yeah, that was that pained me actually.
that's the thing. It's kind of I find him to be a really frustrating player because you can tell he's like skilled. And I was really surprised, like right at the start of the season when I played a pickup with him, like a Pugmy or whatever the hell it was we were playing back then. And I was like, okay, this guy could be legit and he could be really good. But then I play against him and. Sure, he's getting like a Market Gardener drop on Perm like once every three maps. And when it happens, you feel like, oh, you just want to disconnect. But then there's also like 10 free kills. Like every time you play Process, he's in with Market Gardener at the start of like three mids and you win three mids because of it. You get three free mid wins for like one drop per game. It's just, not even per game. It's just like, yeah, it is one mistake, but it's one mistake happening way too often that, that kind of has a lot of bigger impact than he probably realizes it does.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I've heard his justification, and I'll give it here, because I don't think I'm misrepresenting it. But he thinks that going in with his Market Gardener out at the beginning allows him to keep, like, an extra rocket. So if he's coming in with the Market Gardener without, like, instead of shooting a rocket on his approach, if he thinks he's got it lined up properly, he'll go for it. But if he doesn't, then he still has the three rockets for when he actually lands, and he's aiming to, like, bait out some movement or something. The problem with that, like, theory is that in practice it just leads to him dying the majority of the time. It's not like he has a better success rate than other roamers who are just jumping in with their rockets. So that's his justification for why he does it. It's not like some shocking apparently, but I disagree with, you know, once you put it into practice it's blatantly obvious that it doesn't actually work like that.
Like, it doesn't even make sense because, like, you jump in. Like, what? Like, you have extra rocket. You don't. I don't understand. How do you have an extra rocket? Either you jump in and hit him with the Market Gardener and you've done your job, or you jump in and don't have the Market Gardener and you probably don't get any rockets off because you die. Like, you're not going to use those. I don't even understand that.
He's saying he's not shooting one as he approaches, so he has more when he actually lands.
But.
Yeah, I'm not saying it makes sense. I'm just saying that's what he said fair enough. To, like, justify it.
Fair enough. Like, he is a decent player, to be fair. He could be a lot better, though.
Yeah, he's got solid aim, like, if you play against him in pickups, double mixes, or whatever.
The other thing, though, is that if we're considering any of the other roaming soldiers who actually finished in a somewhat decent position, who are you going to nominate apart from Drac? I mean, if we literally work down ETFDL, you've got Drac, then you've got me, and then you've got DD5F, then you've got Ams or Medico, whichever of them happens to be playing Roman Soldier on that day, and the soldiers in that team are like the standout weirdest thing that they have. They're just throwing their lives away all the time. I don't think you can call them like a credit to their team or best Roman Soldier of the season or like in any way an asset other than Tiger. The fact that they're throwing their lives away. But yeah, and then you have to go to like the bottom of the table to find people who are actually doing things for their team, but it's in the context of their team absolutely blowing. So it's people like Infused and Jackie Legs. So Tiger and Jackie Legs at the bottom of the table who are actually doing work for their team and would have potential to be good players if they're in a better surrounding perhaps. But equally, it could just be that they're baiting their teams.
Did Tiger get nominated? Anyway.
No, I don't think so.
I guess he had some big maps, like, you know, where he was like top damaging, top fragging for his team. But like you say, that's in the context of his team, but... He put you to shame on Sunshine, as I remember, Sideshow. He, like, doubled your stats. So.
Yeah, yeah. He was playing really well. I mean, he does play, like, the kind of baity Roma style. He'll sync up with his skill at the times, and instead of him going and baiting the frag into a scout, he'll do it the other way, where, like, his scout will take some damage off and he'll take frag. But yeah, he did play pretty well. And I think it'd be interesting to see him with... I think they're carrying on Team Infused, am I wrong? With at least some of their core together. That was their aim at the beginning of the season.
After their last match, they said they planned to keep the same roster, but you never really know.
Yeah, you never know. But I think the problem in that team isn't Tiger, and it'll be interesting to see how he goes on and develops as a player, because this was really his first season ever in a proper team, I think, never mind his first season in Prem, so it'll be interesting.
Like, what about Medico? I didn't really follow publicly in the latter half of the season. Like, when they actually got Kyren and were actually stable in their roles and stable in their play, like, other than the playoffs, I didn't really...
It was actually painful. Like, it was like... I think Amps has this idea of, when I went back and watched some of the old TLR VODs where he was playing alongside Shadowburn, and Heiss always, Heiss had this theory, even when he played with all of his other teams in Prem, that the soldiers should be going in together, synchronized, in order to build space for the rest of their team, and they would follow up on it. And somehow all of Heiss's teams had like quite a nice follow-up on these. So whenever he would push both of his soldiers in, the rest of his team was able to capitalize on that, probably because he's the main person capitalizing on as a demo man with the space pushing forwards, allowing his scouts to come in as well. But I think Amps has taken that idea, that concept, and tried to implement it in a bit of a strange way, because he just seems to throw himself in and encourage Medico to throw himself in every opportunity, and have the back, like push forward together and make use of that space. It just becomes a vacuum that they then fill with this messy, chaotic play. So, and Medico actually had a fairly big impact on his previous team, Five Rock. So I think it was talent wasted in a way.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. It's like Amps is. He's Mormonism, you know, he's taking the gospel of Heist there and he's added some mad bits to it. But it's like the same thing kept happening game after game, like fucking play after play. Like they do this double soldier bomb and the enemy demo just steps in and shuts them down, like the rest of the team, and then they kill off the soldiers. It just seemed to be like they were bashing their heads against the wall.
The one good time that it did work was their Sunshine Middles. Their Sunshine Middles actually worked out pretty decently. They had this double soldier aggression. They had somehow managed to get the rest of their team to sync it up and move across the point at the same time to find quite a bit of damage whenever they did this bomb. And they had a really nice synergy where Amps would go up on the bell tower and then jump around. Medico would go down at the pit and jump fast from the left. And for some reason, on that mid, it felt like they had kind of figured out how to make that strat work. But they had just kind of blanket applied it to all the rest of their plays when it didn't seem to have a place.
You want to continue this tangent, Cadis? You got any thoughts on the problems of Public Clear and Amps's mindset playing soldier?
Yeah, I can't really disagree with that on the Amps thing, but what I will say is I seem to remember in the playoff game against DD5F, I thought Medico actually played really well, especially on Snakewater. I don't remember the other maps so well, but I remember on Snake he was playing really, really well. And I actually think he was a pretty big miss for them in the semi-final. I actually forgot until like just now when I was checking back. He actually didn't play and Larval Extract played, if you remember. And I don't know, like I remember like watching that game. And I think it could have been quite different if Medico was there. Like, Larval was not up to the level that was needed at all. I remember talking to people after that game, and people told me, like, Larval was, like, kind of the one, like, bright light for publicly in that game. But I think that was just the way the stream did it, and it got some of his nice rockets in. But actually, he was, like, dribbling all over the place. And I think if Medico had been there, that game would have been a lot better. Like I said, I didn't really follow publicly, so it's difficult to comment on kind of the trends they have as a team. But in the playoff game where Medico actually played, I thought he actually played quite well. Not enough to say he should be like here and being voted for, but I think he played pretty well. And I will, just while I'm like having my say, we didn't really talk about Drac at all so far in this.
We're coming to that, man.
Are we coming to that? Okay, fair enough.
You wanna take us there and go for it?
Well, yeah, I just wanted to say my bit on Drac, basically. Like, I think overall, the roaming level has, like, dropped this season. Like, if you think back to even last season, we had, like, I don't remember who was, like, in that Epsi team. Like, who was roaming? I don't even remember who it was. But
Mike.
It was Mike, and then you had, like, Rising and Zebo for us. Demol was, like, on fire last season. So I'd say this season, like, the roaming level has dropped off, but, like, Drac is, like, a really bright point for the future. Like, this season was just a learning season for him, but I think by the end you saw like what that guy is capable of, and he's only going to get better basically. Like, this was his first season playing Roma, let alone playing in Prem, and by like you saw like by the grand finals he was comfortably the best Roma in the division, I think. Maybe not at the start of the season, but like once he got to grips and actually started to have some confidence, he was like really, really good. And again, like talking about like being a role player in a team, he's like really similar to Perm in a lot of ways. Like not always doing like the flashy thing, has to be patient, has to pick his moments because we have a really set style of how we're going to play the game. And he took to that really well, didn't like bitch once. Like he's the main guy I'm giving feedback and criticism to all the way, because he's the one who needs it most, and he takes it all on like all the time. Yeah, I think he completely deserves this award, and I hope he gets it.
I voted for Drake. I don't really have a strong reason as to why, other than I just felt he was the best performer there. I did, you know, similar to what you were questioning, Permzilla sideshow, like, is he the best, or is he just like got the best supporting cast or the least to do? Like, would it matter if Drake had a bad game? Would Nerdy still win?
Well, maybe not. I mean, they might still be able to carry Drake through a game, but I think Drake was actually adding quite a lot to the team as well. He's got some really nice timings that he's developed on when to initiate and when to follow in on the rest of his team. I think possibly because Stark calls a lot for him as well, he's been able to kind of get to grips with when is the best time to initiate a sandwich with the rest of his team, or when is it a good time to try and break through and get either himself or Stark behind. So yeah, they're working really well together, actually. I don't think this is kind of quite the same situation as Permzilla, where you could say, you know, he's just filling a role, or he's got an easy task or whatever. He's actually doing a lot of work as well, and he does have excellent mechanical skill, and he's only going to develop further. As you say, it's his first season, and he's already pretty much this season was head and shoulders above everybody. Whether, you know, if some better players came back, or whether other people develop or something, maybe he won't be head and shoulders above everybody else, but he's still going to be not the best runner for a few months.
Who did you vote for, Slade Joe?
Drak, my boy Drak. I would have voted for myself, you know, if I was in there. But
Sonny Bizzle, who did you vote for?
Drak.
Again, we're all on the same page here. All right, tell us the results, Sonny.
Fourth place goes to Jackie Legs with 16.7%. Third place goes to Dimul with 19.3%. With 26.4%, second place goes to DD5F, and 37.6% go to Drak.
Are you surprised that DD got second there?
Not really.
I'm not. I think that's like it accurately reflects where they finished in the table as well, right? So
That's a good result for him. It's Prem debut. Finishes second in Roma. He still might get another award there. Or was he nominated for the debut? Don't tell me now, Sonny. We'll get to that one.
No.
Put me out of my misery. All right, then. Looking down the awards then. Congratulations to Drake, by the way. And this TF2 dad, Midnight Mick. Follow him on Twitter. Moving down there.
He's a mouthy Mick. That's what you should be called. Midnight Mick keeps giving me stick. I don't need it from you, Mick. I don't need it.
He's in your head.
I get it from everybody else. I don't need it from Drak's dad. Goodness me.
I thought, like, for like half the season, I thought this Drak's dad thing was like some weird joke. And then I realized, no, it's actually Drak's dad.
Somebody was in a Twitch chat. I don't know, was it a Sideshow stream or something? They were like, who's Midnight Mick? And he's Sideshow's dad. So I was trying to get that one going, but it's really cool.
I can't remember how I found Midnight Mick's Twitter, but I think he posted something and it got linked, and I was like, this is amazing. This is actually Drak's dad. It was phenomenal. Gotta give the guy as much publicity as possible, because I think it really gets to Drak as well. which is...
Hello? I don't know if Sideshow's still with us or not. But let's go to
Did I not finish my sentence?
I just cut Kyle on in there, man.
Right, sorry, I said it's brilliant that you, it gets you Drax back is very good.
You and Drax Dad are fighting a land, that's what I gathered. So, Scout of the Season, Hathikul has got a lot invested in this award. You know, he's been beating himself up over last season, and now he thought Stark was going to steal his award. Just building up the tension here. Sonny, tell us first of all, who were the nominees?
Sorex got one nomination, Est got two nominations, Hathikul got 9, and Stark got 16.
The first two names you mentioned there were two players that we were going mad over last season, you know, like Est blown up for Full Tilt, and Sorex wrecking nerds on behalf of LEGO. And they both kind of dropped off this season. Why is that, Kadis? Sideshow. What happened to...
This is having a snack.
What happened to Est and Sorex this season? They had big performances last season.
Sorex definitely has dropped off along with the rest of his team. To be honest, I haven't really seen that much from Sorex. I don't feel like I can properly comment on whether he personally has dropped off more than the rest of his team, or whether his dropping off has contributed to the fall of his team, or what really the problem is there for LEGO. Because it seemed like everybody on that team was just not having an impact in all of their games, and none of them were really stepping up for their team when it was required. But I don't know whether you can really put the blame on Sorex. For Est, I feel like he still did a lot of work for us. It was maybe less of a standout performance from him, and certainly we were in a position where we were kind of expected to take second place right from the beginning rather than being a breakthrough team, so he doesn't quite have that going for him this time. But yeah, I was still impressed with him. I don't think he really dropped off in terms of his performance. I think he's been pretty consistent, and I'm looking forward to carrying on playing with him because he's an excellent player. But the really interesting thing for me is the Hathikul versus Stark.
That is it is another interesting one, like the different roles, obviously, the different play styles. Stark, the more experienced player, the old master, you might say, although he's still a fucking kid to me. Your thoughts on, you know, the matchup Stark versus Hathikul, Kadis, what do they represent to you?
I don't know where to begin, basically. Like, this season was, like, the way we played this season in the big games and the way the games tended to go, there was a lot less room for Stark to kind of do the stuff that only Stark can do, the stuff that really sets him apart from all the other scouts. Because I think in terms of raw ability and, like, what impact scouts can have on the game, Stark is the best scout in Europe and an absolute contender for, like, best scout in the world. But this season, like I say, thinking specifically like in the finals, the game just ended being played at such a slow pace and was like kind of so static in how it was played that there wasn't that much room or even necessity for Stark to make plays and kind of have these carry moments. Like, you still saw them, but often it was just like right place at the right time to turn a fight into a wipe rather than just a convincing victory for us. Whereas Haffy, like, because of his role on the team, he kind of had to be on point from start to finish of every map. And when he wasn't, like, if he's not, then the entire way we play, like, doesn't really work. Like, Stark's the player you look to. When shit's not working, Stark's the player you look to, and he drags us out of those situations. But this season, we were so comfortable so much of the time. And a big part of the reason for that was Hathikul and his play. So I don't know, I found it really difficult to choose because on the one hand, Haffy gets so upset when he doesn't get this award. But on the other hand, he'll be such an intolerable bellend if he wins.
What do you think about this? Let me interject there. Could Stark do Haffy Cole's job?
Stark could do Haffy Cole's job. But
could Haffy do Stark's job?
Haffy could do Stark's job, but I don't think he would do it as well. Stark in Haffy's role.
I feel like, you know, Stark took a hit for the team here. He could have been playing with the heels and doing whatever like he's done in previous seasons, but he allowed Hathikul to get this award.
I think Stark will get bored, honestly, playing this role. It doesn't suit it the way he likes to play the game, and Stark's like, you know, Stark likes to have fun, you know?
Stark would really hate playing in Happy's role. He used to have, like, crazy bitching conversations with me about the way that people, even, like, Samsy played the Pocket Scout role, about just being a massive pussy in the way that he was playing that role. So I think Stark's understanding of how it would be best to play the Pocket Scout role is, you know, taking more of those engagements because he thinks that he can take them. So I don't know whether it would really fit with Nerd Rage. Might be a bit of a clash of personalities there if, you know, Pumzilla is trying to get him to stay with stay with him at all times, and he's off, you know, doing his business while still keeping control of the game. But to come back to you, I think you are being a little bit too too kind to Haffy as well when you say that he could do Stark's job, but a little bit worse. I think it would be quite significantly worse if Haffy was on that aggressive scout role. And whenever he kind of deviates from his play, whenever he's like aggressing into you and forced to make a play or something like that, it's normally very easy to distinguish between the two Nerd Rage scouts as to which one is like aggressing into you and going for the play or whatever. It's normally a lot easier to shut down Haffy Kalori. He hits less of his shots or whatever. And that's not to say that Haffy's a bad scout or whatever, because Stark, as you said, really is like one of the best scouts in the world, probably top three. And yeah, so I think Stark is the better overall player, but you put more pressure on Haffy to perform.
Yeah, but it's also about like what actually happened in this season. And like,
Yeah, fair.
I say, like, in previous seasons, there's just been so many moments where Stark just, like, does shit, and we just win because of it, whereas this season, like, particularly in the final, which is what, like, I'm thinking back to, it was, like, it was a lot more just about, like, the pack and how the pack played for us.
The system won.
Yeah, basically.
I think some of that is down to how we have been, like, trying to counter your playstyle. Last season, we were consistently screwed, and I imagine other teams were as well, by Stark getting behind in these situations, and you end up either searching for him, or he would like sandwich at the same time as Nerd Rage pushed forward, and you just get caught in this horrible vice. And so we made a real concerted effort to make sure that Stark couldn't get behind in these situations, which just led to us being, you know, super cautious and not pushing, not being aggressive. We were coming in from behind. But not to say that we locked Stark out or something, but because we and other teams are not, you know, pushing into Nerd Rage and trying to initiate these messy fights that we think we'll lose because they'll get a player in flanking and crush us, it maybe allowed Stark to come in less. You're playing against are also playing slower, as well as your team making sure that you're playing a rigid style.
We all know that Captain is actually the best scout in Nerd Rage. He is ridiculously good, actually. But I voted for Haffy Kill, you know, because fuck Stark. I want to see Haffy win. That was my main motivation. He obviously played very well this season. His stats were excellent. If I was, you know, to say who's the best scout, the two of them, you know, like looking at their historical records, whatever. Stark for sure, but for this season I'm putting my money on Haffy Kill. Who did you guys vote for?
I voted for Haffy Kill in the end. Like I said, there's no, like, no one wins. If Haffy Kill loses, he's upset. If he wins, then I don't want to be around him. But I've experienced him losing, you know, so in the interest of fairness, I should at least experience the pain of him winning before I make my judgment about what's worse. So I voted for Haffy this time. But like I said, I think Stark is the best scout there is, pretty much, with the exception of maybe Clockwork, but we won't know really. But this season, Haffy was more important to the team, I think, just because of the way the matches fell. Well, arguably. I don't know. It's a toss-up. I give it to Haffy this time, basically.
I think I voted for Stark. I think another thing, just to throw in Stark's corner, is his calling ability for the flank and how he can direct Draco or somebody like that. And although Haffy Kull kind of performs that role in that he's a center of the team that everybody else can revolve around, like Perm can just follow him whenever he's like a lost little lamb, and the other players can return back to Haffy because they know that's where the heels are going to be. I think Stark has more of an ability to control the flank side with his calling. I think he's got a real skill with how he coordinates the team.
Would the combo melt down if Stark was in there as well? Would there be too much dissent amongst the ranks, Hercules, if Stark was actually playing Havoc's role? Would the comms break down? Used to be locking horns.
I don't think so. I think Stark might upset Permser a little bit because you have to be a bit tender with Perm at times, you know?
I can just imagine it.
I think we would play worse because I think Stark would just get really fucking bored, and Stark, like, when he can get, sometimes he gets bored and doesn't focus, and then because you expect so much of him, when you don't get it, like, you set yourselves up like you're gonna get that, and if he's bored, like in scrims and shit, then things start to stagnate because he's like, you know, obviously that's what happens when people get bored. So I don't think it would work as well in a team chemistry sense, but in terms of ability, like, he could probably do the role like better than anyone else, but you know, he likes to have fun.
Sonny Black, who did you vote for?
I think I voted for Stark.
So we got a split here, two halfies, two Starks. Tell us the results, Sonny.
34.4% and 288 votes go to the second place, that is Huffy Cool.
Oh, rest in peace!
Oh, wins with 65.6% or 548 votes.
No.
No love for Huffy Cool. Stark's gonna be like the new Mike, he just wins all the awards. Congratulations, Stark.
Even if he blows. I think Stark should try and have a terrible season next season and still win.
So, Cadis, who are you going to get to replace Happy Cool now that he's quit the game?
I don't know. Like,
get Piers.
Yeah, I guess I get Piers. He's like Happy Cool, but with better DM. Happy's just going to... Like, I don't know, man. Like, Happy Cool was so upset when Stark was going back on scout, because originally at the start of the season we were looking for a scout because Stark wanted to roam, but we couldn't find anyone that fit properly, so Stark ended up back on scout. I think Happy knew then that he lost his award, and this just confirms it.
I'm sad, but you know, there's always next season, Happy Cool.
Why is he messaging me? He's messaging me abuse. I voted for him.
Me too, Happy Cool. No abuse, please. Mean? Send your abuse to Saicho and Sonny Black.
I just sung his praises for like 10 fucking minutes. He messages me, fuck you.
My
like,
vote wouldn't
this?
Have changed it.
I didn't win.
Stuck on like twice the votes.
Let's go.
He should just get better.
Next award, let's go. Off-classer of the season, please, Sonny Black. The nominations.
Nominated were AMS with one nomination, Denya with one nomination, Demul with 3 nominations, Ixi with 3 nominations, Stark with 5, and Stalash with 12.
Is the Amps one for him playing heavy, the Thomas Love heavy on Zaya? I think it is. I can't remember him making any other play. Maybe a spy play that failed completely. Is the others are all sniper? Is this essentially, this is sniper of the season, right? Or anybody else who made any other plays?
Can I get the list again? I was too busy being brutalized by Happy Call over Steam to... But listen.
Ems and Denya didn't make it in. Demul, Ixi, Stark, and Talash made it in.
Okay.
Talash with the majority of the votes there as well. What was it, 12 versus 5 for Stark?
Yeah.
Do we have to consider anything apart from Sniper here? I'm racking my brains, but I can't think of anybody who even made spy plays out of those guys. Demul, maybe, made one? I can't think of any that were momentous.
I mean, the hype this season was around Thalash. He was just showing up, putting up some big sniper sprees, making some highlights on YouTube, of course. I'm sure that sways the votes slightly. But talk to me about your nomination, Cadis.
I kind of based my nomination around, like, I had this huge internal conflict of who to nominate for Scout of the Season out of Haffy and Stark. So in the end, I decided to do the only fair thing and nominate Haffy for Scout because I could nominate Stark for Off-Classer.
Okay.
But I don't know. I don't really pay that much attention to the whole Off-Class thing. Like in terms of like who's doing it the best, because it's so like, I don't know. It's so much harder to judge. Like Thalash had the best moments by a mile, but at the same time, like for every like the bigger the play that Thalash made, the bigger Full Tilt would fuck up in making any use of it whatsoever. Like, he drops Condom and Gollywash last, they push, they fail, and it's just like, what was even the point of that momentous play? He drops Permzilla, like, in the final, in a ridiculous fashion. and then they failed to push out. And I mean, if you want to talk about that situation, the reason they failed to push out was because Stark hit one headshot on the pocket and it fucked the whole push. But then we're actually able to capitalize off the back of that. So, you know, like, it's again, I find it difficult to kind of separate considering how the team works around it to how the plays actually happen. Like, Thalash made the bigger plays and probably should have had the bigger impact. But in terms of how their plays were actually converted, I think Stark deserves a fair shout at the same time. But it's kind of like a weird one, but yeah, I only really remember the flashy plays, so it's kind of like Thalash probably deserves it in that sense.
Your nomination, Saicho? Do you remember?
Yeah, I think mine was Thalash, just because he does make these crazy plays sometimes. Like, he'll just occasionally dig you out of a situation. I'm thinking earlier in the season as well on the Snakewater, I think it was, and he was just, I can't even remember which team it was against, but it was getting down to the final minutes, and I think it was getting pretty close.
It's
and
Planet Express, goes, right?
Possibly, yeah. And he just pop, and hits like three headshots in a row, and you win a round off it. So, yeah, I think it's fair to think about how the team capitalizes in a sense, but really, this is just about the player who was making the off-class plays, and whether or not that your team capitalizes on it, the player has no influence on that. It's not like Stark or Thalash can do anything more than just make the plays as well as they can.
Yeah, but I'm talking about like how I remember them, and I kind of, when I think back to games, I remember the plays that led to significant moments.
Yeah, yeah.
As well as, well, I try to remember the plays that led to significant moments, as well as just the plays themselves. So it's kind of, my memory is kind of blurred by it, was the point I was trying to make.
Mm. So, yeah, I think it was Thalash this season. He definitely off-classed more than everybody else, I think. I don't think there was anyone else who off-classed as much as he did.
Demu.
Yeah, possibly. But he, yeah, he came up with it, so that's why I voted for him, essentially.
Something Stark does really, really well on Sniper, I have to say, is he gets meaningless picks after meaningless picks and will not fucking die, so we can do something other than having him snipe. We have these situations over and over again where he'll just, we'll try to push last and he'll just kill a scout or like kill a soldier or something meaningless like this and just rotate positions for 10 minutes doing this over and over again, like headshotting their sniper and just not dying. So we're stuck with him on Sniper like for eternity, it feels like.
He's just too smart. He's just,
yeah, it is. It drives me crazy at times because it's like, okay, their medic knows, like, you're not going to get the medic. There's no way of really making that happen. We're just unable to get out of the situation now because he's too good to die.
Anyone else bothered at all that, you know, a second string scout like Thalash plays all right last season, but pretty much, you know, is on Ast's coattails, then shows up here, a guy who was formerly banned in ETF2L and suddenly has an amazing season on Sniper.
I always find it a bit dodgy when, you know, the VAC meme come out in Twitch chat, because it's like, can you really, like, I don't know, is it really funny to use this if he's actually been VAC'd before? I don't know how I feel about that.
Trigger,
I'm not sure it has the same effect.
Trigger warning, God.
Do you think maybe it's the same for anyone who's ever had like a good run on Sniper? You're thinking of Flippy, like, is does Thalash hide his subpar scout play behind his Sniper play?
I think he improved a lot on Scout as well this season. He had his best Scout performance by a mile.
I kind of felt that too, actually. Like, part of the reason Ast wasn't so amazing is because Thalash had stepped up.
Yeah, like, he's been playing better and better. Like, he's been steadily improving. Thalash has actually been around for, like, fucking ages.
Yeah, for a long time, he's been steadily improving. Yeah. I remember when he was pretty bad, and now he's pretty good. So, yeah, he's doing pretty well. Yeah, I wouldn't say he's covering up for, like, a bad scout performance in the way that some snipers have. Even Flippy, I mean, he had a good scout performances. He only very occasionally hid like a bad season behind some sick frags. But no, I don't think this was a bad season for Thalash. I mean, sometimes he does it off class more than I'd like him to. But I think whenever you've got in your team, it's so difficult for them to resist the temptation just to turn to the dark side and pick up the sniper rifle whenever they spawn and they realize there's going to be a slower pace to the game.
Quick shout out then to the other guys who made it into the vote. Sunny Black, who was it? Ixie and
Ems.
Oh, the Ems one. That
I thought Ixie
was
actually heavy. Like, Ixie was actually really consistent on Sniper in the kind of second half of the season in playoffs. I didn't really follow DD5F too much at the start, but kind of like, I don't know. He wasn't like amazing and doing incredible things, but it was like whenever he was going sniper, I felt like, you know when you just kind of, you see someone go sniper and you don't think, oh my God, here comes a 10-minute stalemate. You just kind of instinctively think, oh, okay, they got him on sniper. Something's probably going to happen. I had this feeling with Ixie in like the second half of the season, which tells me he was probably doing something right. So he's like an honorable mention.
He also had a big game on Viaduct. One of the games they put him on sniper on Via, and he was not coming out with these flashy plays like you see in the frag moves or whatever, but doing what Flippy used to do, which is just consistent headshots around the map, and it would just allow his team to win these team fights. So I thought that was really good from that from Ixie actually on Via. I don't particularly remember much more than that. I don't remember, like Kedda said, about these stalemates or situations like that, but I do remember that one Viaduct game where he was just very, very consistent. It was the kind of sniper play you really want. They don't just occasionally clutch like a big win, but if they consistently hit and just big damage on people, then you're going to overall have the advantage in a lot of the team fights.
Do you think there's a big pool of talent or energy for Italian players? It's like Ixie shows up and starts to do well, Sorex drops off a little bit,
Pierre as well,
a big bowl of pasta. Yeah, Pierre's as well. There's less pasta available for Sorex now. He's like the runt of the litter. Think about it,
communal,
you know?
Carbonara.
Dallas then, I voted for Thalash, big moments, flashy plays, that's what I want to see. Who did you guys actually vote for?
Thalash.
You mentioned Stark.
Yeah, I voted for Stark, but like I said, I just had some crazy like frenzy of bias when I did it. It was like I just deliberately refused to put genuine thought into it, so I just decided to be biased to make it easier on myself. But Thalash probably deserves it, I think.
Sonny, who'd you vote for?
Thalash.
Okay, let's go. Give us the results, man.
Ixie got fourth place with 11.1%. Dimul got third place again.
Dimul was in it?
Yeah.
I thought you said Ems.
No, Ems got one and Stenya got one. Dimul got third place with 15.1%. Second place with 18.2% goes to Stark, and Thalash wins with 55.6%.
It appears that the voters remember these big flashy plays that get put in frag movies, etc.
That's it, man. That's it. Exactly it.
As Adaban used to win all of the awards.
Dimul, though, we didn't necessarily talk about, but like when I see Dimul off class, more often than not, I feel like he's just bored playing the game, and he's like, I died. I'm going to go off class, not really with regard to what is best for his team at the time. But, I'm just I'm disillusioned with LEGO this season. I've always been a fan of LEGO, even though I hate to watch them play. I always hoped they could do something, and they switched up their roster a couple of seasons ago, managed to have success, but now they've gone off. I'm pointing the finger of blame at Dimul. Stop off-classing.
Yeah, there's definitely something wrong there, but I'm not sure what it is, and I don't think you pin the blame on all on Dimul or all on his off-classing or whatever. There's something very, very wrong with how their scouts are working with the rest of their team, but I cannot put my finger on it. I need to watch more of their games back or something.
Let's keep it rolling then. Do we want to go to the best player of the season? That's the next one down. We'll go to that, yeah. Sonny Black, tell me the nominations. Best player of the season.
Thalash got one. Est got one, Efikul got two, Captain got three, and Stark and Kadis both got 10.
So who actually made it into the votes then?
Stark, Kadis, and Captain.
Wow, that is the story of the season right there. All three players from Nerd Rage. Is that fair, Sideshow?
Yes. I'm not going to be around the bush. Yeah, it is.
But talking
there wasn't
about,
really there wasn't really like a standout player from one of the other teams. Like that's the only way that you can contest. If you have this one dominant team throughout a season, the only way you can ever have another contender for best player of the season is if you have like a single carry player from the second or third best team. And there wasn't really that. I mean, there's no standout carry player in Perilous. There's no standout carry publicly, so there was no contest for these Nerd Rage guys.
I'm tempted to go off on a tangent here, you know, because I feel from these nominations, you would feel like it was a bad season, but it really wasn't. It was a very competitive season outside of the number one team. But
and the overall level was pretty good as well, because sometimes you can have a very competitive season where the overall level is really poor. But I think if you compare it even to like last season, where LEGO seemed to have dipped in performance, but they were really kind of around the same level, maybe slightly lower. And the bottom end of Prem was really highly competitive with all the way up to the third place. So I think overall, the overall skill level probably perhaps even increased. It was just that the skill gap at the top was fairly large.
I'll jump in here. I voted for Kadis. I don't know who you guys nominated. I don't care. But I voted for Kadis because of what I said before, that not just this season had he put together this best team and managed to keep it together, he'd also stepped up his own game. A real kind of return to form. Round of applause for Jason Allen. I hope he wins.
He hasn't yet.
I hope he wins. Saito, who did you vote for or nominate, whatever?
Can't actually remember. I'm fairly sure it was either Kadis or Stark. Stark does a lot of work for his team. He's an excellent player. He has a large impact in the season, and also as does Kadis. They're kind of like two roles on the combo and the flank. I can't remember who I nominated in the end. I think probably Kadis is more as the leader of the team, who's also brought in the new talent and is constantly giving them criticism and helping them improve as well. But yeah, I can't remember.
You nominated Stark.
There you go.
I'm not going to talk this one out anymore, Sonny Black. I want you to tell me who you voted for and then hit me with the results.
I think I voted Kadis.
Good vote.
Hmm?
Good vote, yeah.
the results. This one's the closest one at the top with only, by the time I closed it, only two votes between first and second place.
Just get a close-up of Kadis' face there, you know, and see the reaction.
But in third place with...
Hafikul's going to be so mad if Stark wins it as well.
In third place with 23% and 194 votes is Captain. In second place with 323 votes, and therefore only two behind the first place with 325. Second place is Kadis, and Stark wins it.
Oh,
kapow! Son of a bitch. Oh.
And Stark's just going to be gloating more than ever as well. Wins best scout, contender for best off-classer, wins
Man,
best
I'm
player.
Now. Stark didn't do shit. What was the same result? Dear God.
Yeah, I can, you know, I'm not upset by that result. I was back in the Jason Allen horse, but Stark wins. I think that's a fair result as well. But, you know, I don't know, what does the best player of the war or best player of the season award represent? Like, would Nerd Rage suffer more with the loss of Kadis or the loss of Stark, Sideshow?
That's an interesting question, actually. I think in previous seasons, it would have absolutely been Kadis. Like, if they had lost Kadis, it would have just been a catastrophe and the whole team would have fallen apart. Now, it's probably still Kadis. But in sticky situations, more often than not, it's Stark who manages to pull the team out by their coattails. And, you know, Kadis can have, like, quite a lax game, and the rest of the team will still perform around him. But if Stark's required to perform and doesn't, then it can really hurt them. I don't know. I think probably, you know, on reflection, it's Kadis who deserves it, but I'm fairly happy that Stark gets it.
Stark says in Twitch chat, only two votes above Kato. Good thing I voted for myself on both my accounts. Roasted. Just while we're talking, you know, about Nerd Rage here, Permzilla messaged me quite a while ago, actually, to say, Kid has removed me from the Nerd Rage roster. Make sure you ask him about it at some point. And this was just today, right, Kid? You just dropped Permzilla from your team? What?
Yeah, I've had enough of that shit, to be honest. Now, you see, Permzilla, over the past, I don't know, 3 or 4 seasons, been a nice habit of leaking the results to his close friends before the show.
What a scumbag.
And I was like, Perm, that's just not cool, bro. And so this season, when he tried to give me the results, I was like, Perm, don't message me those results, so I'm going to remove you from the team. And he just linked me all the results without me even asking for them. Just like, goddamn, Perm, I told you what would happen. And yeah, I followed through. Man of my word.
I hear Honey Badger's looking for a team.
Give me a trial. I'm ready. Let's go. Next award, Sonny Black. Congratulations to Stark once again. Commiserations, Kiedis. But I think you're both winners, to be honest.
That's close vote. Loves it, man. It's all good.
Premiership debut of the season. Sonny Black, please. The nominees.
DD5F got one nomination. Ediski got one nomination. XC got one nomination. Jackie Legs got one nomination. Tiger got 2, Sharpie got 2, all of those didn't make it in. Pires got 8 and Drake got 12.
Two horse race here. I'm just going to come straight out and say I voted for Pires, you know. Definitely an exciting player to watch. He had some really hot and cold performances, you know, like terrible one map, amazing the next. But more exciting for me than Drake because I feel like, you know, there is an element of Drake being in the best team. Although he did win, though, and this is the reason I voted for Permzilla last season. So, you know, I'm just conflicted here, but I don't know. I like flashy Italian stallion plays. I can't really justify it, guys. I'm a mess. I've got no consistency whatsoever, but Pires is my vote. What were you thinking on this one, Sideshow?
I nominated Pires because I knew that Drake would get nominated, and I wanted Pires. Definitely get a place in the voting. I think if Drak had not been picked up by Nerd Rage, then this would have been a really interesting well. So all of those other people who didn't actually get in to vote probably did deserve a position, and there was so much new talent in Prem this season, and a lot of which actually did perform fairly well. Certainly on par with other people in Premiership that you could compare them to at the same level. But it's difficult to contend against somebody whose first season in Premiership on a role that they've never played before ends up winning the season. So I think it will probably go in a landslide to Drak, even though there's only two people in it in the end. But yeah, I thought Pierre's had a really good performance, and even though his team was so messy and felt like they were up and down and all over the place and didn't quite know what they wanted to do, that guy played some incredible TF2 from a mechanical point of view, and also just being able to work with other players at the end of a team fight and just come in and destroy everybody. He had some great individual performances, and they give hope for future performances. The same team or with a different team, I think he's a real talent.
Kiedis?
Yeah, I'm with Drak. I think Drak definitely deserves it because he just fit in seamlessly, basically. But, I mean, it's fair to say Drak had a bit of an advantage because he's fitting into an existing winning team, basically. He's the only new guy. Everything else is the same as the team that won last season. They have like a really set style of play that he had to fit into, and he deserves all the credit in the world for doing that. But I mean, the other guys, they had a completely different like job to do, basically. Like Pires is playing his first season in Prem in a new team with a whole bunch of inexperienced players and no real like thinking about that team. There's no real vocal leader or someone who's gonna, you know, has a bounty of experience that he can benefit from and who's actually like articulate or dedicated enough to actually give him, you know, the input that he needs. So he deserves a lot of credit as well, as do a bunch of the others, to be fair. Like, they deserve a bunch of credit, but you know, you have to wonder, like, what could they have done if they had Drak's opportunity as well? But I mean, I can only judge based on what they actually did. And Drak had the best opportunity, sure, but he made the most of it and hit a much higher peak than the rest of them. So I went with Drak, basically, for that reason.
I think the reason I kind of went against my usual instincts of, like, the guy made his premiership debut and won the season, he's obviously the worthy winner of this award, is because I already knew Drak was good. And, like, I was blown away by Perez, like, and no expectations of him. And you could say the same about a lot of these other players who stepped up. That Sonny Black mentioned the other nominees, but I don't know, I just love that story. I went with it. Sonny Black, who did you vote for?
I think I voted for Drak.
Boo.
It's actually worth mentioning, like, before the season started, before, like, when we were considering, because I told you before, like, Stark wanted a roam, we were looking at scouts. And we always had Drak as, like, our backup plan. Like, if we couldn't find a scout, we were going to try Drak on Roamer and Stark would scout, because Stark really wanted a roam. He likes to have fun. Said it before. Perez was actually the guy we were, like, mainly looking at. But a whole bunch of drama happened because he kind of committed himself to Planet Express. Sheepy got really upset when he said he wanted to troll for us still. A whole bunch of drama happened. We never really ended up playing with him properly. But I was talking about, like, you know, what opportunities players got and how could it have been. It could have been really different, because if Perez had decided to try playing with us, you know, good player, and it might have worked out.
That could have been really interesting as well.
Yeah, so it could have been, like, everything could have been so different, basically. I think it was worth pointing out.
Yeah. Because just because it's his premiership debut as well, we have not seen how he's played, like, whether he could play out in that situation, or whether he, if with a better team, he would be even better than the few flashes of brilliance that we've seen from him with Planet Express. So, you know, the fact that he hasn't got that opportunity with Nerdridge almost just makes me more excited to see him next season with anybody else.
Go ahead then, Sonny Black. Hit us with the results.
Second place with 381 votes and 45.4% is Drak, and with 458 votes and 54.6% Spurious wins.
Take that in your pipe and smoke it at midnight.
Wait, what? Who won? I was too busy looking at that pixelated lady.
Perez wins. Let's go with Italy.
Oh. What?
Really?
Yes. What was the vote split again there, Sage or Sonny Black?
About 70 votes difference, or
how many percent?
9%.
So it was close, yeah, but people just love the hot shot scouts, man. The pasta, big pasta.
I'm really surprised.
Yeah, I didn't expect that.
I felt Drak was going to win it by a landslide just because of where he finished the season and the fact that he was actually playing really well. I guess maybe people wait the incredible, like, you know, that single play that has been all over with him in PC, where he just jumps over and just two shots condom to drop him as they're pushing out. That was fantastic, but I guess maybe frag clips are better than where you finish in the season.
It really is a popularity contest. And I only feel slightly bad for Drak, sorry. You already won one award, but it's cool to see Perez coming in here and stealing that one. Rest in peace, Drak fans. Let's go on to the real award, you know, the one everybody's wants to know about. I used to be pretty invested in this award, you know, it meant a lot to me, but I've just been beaten down season after season here by the man in the camera next to me, or wherever he is on the screen. But it is the caster of the season award.
Did you just see Twilight Tom in the background as well?
Twilight Tom, who?
That's my dad. Drak from Midnight Mick. My dad's Twilight.
Lovely, lovely. Tell us about the nominees here, Sonny Black.
As always, I took every caster that casted at least three matches. So Bren, News, Twiggy, Josh, Jackie Lex, and Halo with one, and Kermit with two disqualified for that. And Into the Pulse made Cadis with 3, War with 5, Sideshow with 5, Beaten and Rival with 7, Turbo Taps with 8, Max with 9, and Commander X with 11.
I didn't actually compile the stats for TFTV this season, so I trust you, Sonny Black. But I voted for Sideshow. I don't think he... How many games did you say Sideshow cast it?
Five.
And I cast how many?
Seven.
See, like, we didn't really do much this season, I feel. Obviously, you were playing, but I was kind of taking a back seat with a lot of the organizational stuff. TurboTabs was running the show. And Dave the Wind, you know, setting up the cast, getting the staff. Commander X really stepped up and cast a whole bunch of games. So, I salute those guys, but who do I think is the best caster? I vote for Sideshow. Sorry. Suck it.
I think Max is a really nice up-and-coming caster. He doesn't really have the whole professional vibe going on that you would maybe want from, like, a more serious tournament when he's not just casting too well. And CX, you know, has always been there. He's just a real stable pillar of the casting group. But yeah, I was playing this season. I didn't get to cast as much as I would have liked to. I was also taking a backseat with some other organizational stuff.
See, the TF2, that's what you were doing, mate.
It's saved.
Sideshow is the hero that we deserve or need. I don't know. He's doing so much in the background this season and future seasons. Sideshow, who did you vote for?
I can't remember. Who did I have no idea. I don't even think I voted. Possibly voted for myself. Who knows?
Kiris, your thoughts on this award?
To be honest, man. I don't really know. How many games has Sideshow cast?
Five.
That's not enough. How many games did you cast?
Seven.
Yeah, that's enough. You deserved it, man. Like, I really hope you win. I think CX is never going to win. Like, he doesn't have the popularity, but I think CX deserves a lot more recognition than he gets for the work that he does. To kind of agree with what you guys said about Max as well. I mean, I'm going to lie, he's a little bit peeved with some of the things he said in the Grand Final cast.
I haven't even watched it back yet.
I'm still triggered. Some moments where, you know, called us certain words, and I think it kind of just, based on not understanding exactly what was going on at the time, maybe should frame things a little better. But I'm digging the Max cast as well. I don't really fucking know, man. Like, I'm just glad people cast the fucking game at the end of the day. They will deserve it.
It's really incredible to have this pool of talent available right now, like really genuinely great casters rising up. Like Max, you say, is like great flow. He's just such a natural on the mic. To see him and Beater at DreamHack Winter was a real pleasure as well. I'm a big fan of Beater. Commander X continues to be an excellent caster. It's kind of weird, actually, that he doesn't get more recognition. And someone I'd like to shout out as well, I know TurboTabs, he really beats himself up a lot. But he put in a lot of work this season and this year, or like, you know, the past 12 months, whatever. And he continues to get better and better. So if it wasn't for Sideshow,
he does so much work behind the scenes as well. Like, he organizes almost every cast along with David the Win, like making sure that everybody's there and everybody turns up and gets all the information from everyone. He's really stepped up in terms of the actual organizational work. Although that's not what the award is for. So
organizer of the season, though.
Just wanna let
it be something
you know,
black.
We've got love for you.
Organize of the season.
I was glad to see War cast in more games as well this season. You know, I'm a War fan too. He and CX in particular are a great combo. But go ahead, Sonny Black. Tell us who you voted for and then hit us with the results.
I actually voted for TurboTabs because it makes me sad to see him down there every time. But yeah.
What did he get last time? Did he get 1%?
He'd been going up, had he not? He'd been getting improving season on season.
Wait, for casters, I have a whole spreadsheet with all the results. Now, TurboTabs got 3.7% last time.
He's got the fastest rate of increase out of anybody. He got a 300% increase from last time.
Yeah, before that he got 1%.
This time you should get 9.
Piss over misery, Sonny Black. Oh my god.
TurboTabs got last place with 30 votes or 3.5%.
Yeah.
Is that up from last season?
It's down 0.2%.
Oh, fuck. No.
It's leveled out. It's leveled out.
And it's down 6 votes from last time as well.
But there were less votes overall in these awards, right?
Yeah.
Sorry, continue something. I didn't mean to derail you.
How many are there? 7th place with 41 votes and 4.8% is Commander X.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
What?
That's cruel.
Where?
That's
how many?
That's a crime. He finished second and last.
With
despite having cast the most games.
What percentage?
4.8%.
Man, that's
that is a bit crazy, actually. Like, CX is one of our better, like... Yeah, he's one of our better casters for either play-by-play or analytical. He's actually got a pretty good insight into how the game works and how the teams are flowing and stuff, so...
That's bullshit.
Definitely needed more than that.
I think he just doesn't, like... He doesn't quite fit into, like... into any real niche where people can, like, identify him as, like, you know, CX is that caster that gives you, like, this thing. So he doesn't, like, stick out. Like, he's no one's favorite caster, I guess, but... He's like so many people's like second or third favorite, but you know he's not really anyone's favorite. So everyone's voting for someone else, and he's just kind of, you know, if it was who's your second favorite caster of the season, he'd be
he'd
way
win
up
by
there,
a landslide.
We need the proportional representation for this poll next season, please, Sonny Black. Put that down in your notepad. Keep going though.
He's died.
Nope. Sixth place with 48 votes and 5.6% is Max. Fifth place with 59 votes and 6.9% is Cadis. Only one vote more, 60 votes and 7% is Beta. Third place to War with 112 votes or 13.1%. Second place. Only 18 behind first place with 28.5% and 243 votes is admirable, and Sideshow wins with 261 votes and 30.6%.
I'm a god, what can I say?
But it's getting closer. Like
it is. I need to cast more games. That certainly wasn't enough 5 this season, I'm letting it slip.
Only 2.1% difference. Last time it was 9%, and before that it was like 30.
Admirals catching back up.
I've
or maybe
just
I'm canceled
just my subscription to Sideshow Stream.
You have good internet now, though, right? So all you have to do is stream this season. That's gonna get you 18 votes at least.
All I need to do is play in the Premiership and be the worst at my class, which you know I've done for season after season. You know, no problem. No, again, Sideshow.
I was actually having this existential crisis where I was like, right, I'm playing Roma in the second best team, but I can't think of a Roma in Prem who's worse. I was like, having this crisis of identity. But never fear, I'm coming back. I'm going to be better than ever.
Playing
I'm
going
to be blasting these kids out of the water.
You're going to keep playing for Perilous?
Yeah, I had a discussion with them where I tried to cut myself and they refused.
I was going to say, because I heard some rumours about who your replacement might have been, if it happened.
Oh yeah, yeah, I was peddling that rumour for a while. I think it was just before the playoffs. People were suggesting that Sideshow was going to stand down before LAN, because he could cast at LAN or whatever. And who, you know, what TF2 legend might they get back in for LAN? MG Mike? Was that the one you were talking about, Cadis?
It was MG someone. Sideshow still there? Or is he just completely
Yeah,
lagged?
Yeah, no.
All right, you're
no,
like,
I'm still here.
Like,
yeah,
a statue.
Yeah.
I thought maybe you lagged out.
No, no, I'm just, you know, not giving anything away.
Poker face. Right.
Yeah, there were a few people that we were thinking about, but yeah, it was just an open dialogue with our team about what would be the best situation. I'm under absolutely no pretenses that I'm a god at TF2, so it's... yeah, it's just an open dialogue of how to keep improving and keep our team forward.
Well, removing your worst player would be a good start.
Probably would. And that's why Thalish is gone.
I actually don't think that team would actually last that long without you. Not like because of the in-game stuff, but like I think I could see it. Like I don't know. I think you bring a lot to the team sideshow. Not like skill or ability, but you bring a lot.
Sideshow, no you are an excellent TF2 player. That's the troubling thing, because you know you watch Sideshow stream. He's clearly talented in MGE. He reviews a lot of demos and says a lot of smart things. But when it comes to your games, when you're playing the game, it's like the visor comes down. I don't know. You put on your dribble helmet. And like you don't seem to think about what you're doing, or like
the Magneto everything, helmet
everything
of
you
dribble.
Know, and like all your, I don't know, just the decisions you make. It's not like your mechanical skills or whatever. It's just like the things you do. I don't get it, man. I don't get it. It's like one of the biggest mysteries in TF2. How can you be so good at TF2, yet so bad at TF2 at the same time?
It's a mystery. I can only hope I inspire other people to be. as good bad as me.
I want to see you stay next season, and I don't know, like unlearn everything that you've learned. You can do this, Sideshow. You could be rumor of the season. I believe. Genuinely.
Can we bring you on as coach at Marvel? Can you just whisper sweet nothings in my ear?
I could
season?
Be like a sports psychologist. You know, I probably couldn't tell you what to do in the game, but I could definitely. Unlock your potential, Sideshow. I definitely think I could.
How much do you charge? That's the only question.
Free 99, man. Just throw the caster of the season award my way. Gonna do.
Fair enough, then. It's done. We're gonna be propelled to new great heights once I unlock my potential. Those solo Sideshow bombs are gonna be killing everybody. I'll just run in and 1v6 them.
I'm gonna start streaming, right? And all I'm gonna do is review Sideshow demos. So that's where I'm gonna. That's gonna be my niche.
So I'm gonna. Don't bother. Otherwise, I'll start reviewing admirable demos. And
we can help each other. We can build each other up, man. Anyway, congratulations to Sideshow. Definitely a worthy winner. You're my hero. I embraced you warmly at Gamers Assembly. Feel the love, brother. Feel the love.
I kiss your forehead.
There are a lot of people kiss my forehead, man. I hope you. Rinse your mouth out after that, but let's ask Kadis actually. How soon do you want to go to bed, buddy?
Do we have more things to go over?
We could talk about a bunch of stuff, you know, or we could save it for another show, like in a week's time or later after some announcements have been made.
Well, I'm not in any huge rush, so use your best judgment. I am open to either.
I think I think we should tease people before Sunny leaves and then save it for a future show. You know? It'll tie us into actually producing one. You know, everyone will be like, oh, where's the Fully Charged? What are you going to talk about? Whatever. And then we'll feel obliged to put one on.
Okay, whilst we still have Sunny Black here, let's quickly ask him, what plans do ETF2L have for Season 24? Because I was really infuriated when I saw the ETF2L April's Fool about how you were gonna, you know, no unlocks or no whitelist, no class limits. Maybe that was a bit beyond, but is that not the direction that TF2 is heading in? Why is that a joke?
Because, like, we've tried to introduce new weapons to the game every season, and we will continue to do that, but probably not all of them at once. And, for example, class limits is something that will probably remain as it is for now.
Yeah, I could understand the class limits one, but just particularly the whitelist. Why not, Sonny Black? Why not just say, go ahead, no whitelist this season? You've been, you know, adding more and more unlocks. What's a few more? What's the quick fix? What's the gunslinger? What's the criticola in there, Sonny Black?
Like, there's just certain weapons like the quick fix. Like, the Americans had it for a season, and everyone had to run it because there was simply...
They didn't even have it for a season, they had it for, like, the playoffs after they made the balance change. That was the crime in itself. Kadis, do you think the game would be drastically different if we had no whitelist next season?
Yeah, it would be completely different.
Would it be AIDS? Would it be worse?
Yeah, it would be terrible. I think we should totally get there at some point, but I think with matchmaking in as it is now, Valve will probably use matchmaking to balance stuff anyway. But I don't think there's a huge need for us to jump the gun, suffer like 3 months of shit, because they're going to get all the same feedback from matchmaking itself. Like, I mean, if they're just looking at like weapon stats and weapon usages, like Quick Fix is going to get balanced because I don't see anyone not running Quick Fix in matchmaking. Like, kind of the same story for like the Whip, Soldier Whip. Like, those are the two like big ones for me, because they just change like the dynamic of like mid fights completely. And obviously, we want to go, you know, we want to go a bit toward what Valve want, like with everything being open. But that just like, that just changes so much, so like straight away, just by two weapons. That's not even taking in like, you know, like all the little changes that all the other things make. Those two weapons by themselves change just everything. So I think Valve will probably, especially Quick Fix, like Valve are probably going to get on that. There's no need for us to like rush into anything.
Sideshow then, you know, maybe, I'm not even sure if I'm playing Devil's Advocate here or if I'd really love to see the chaos unfold, but you know, offer me a compromise here. I want to see some high impact unlocks added next season. Which, you know, which ones would you cherry pick to mix things up?
I think just one note before I talk about that though is that this is quite an important season for if you were choosing to make those decisions for ETF2L, because this season of ETF2L, one would assume the rule set, etc., would be then used for I-58 because it's the season preceding it. And with no similar changes happening across the pond or in Australia or even in Asia, then those changes would a bit mad. It would be chaotic because people just before the LAN would have to suddenly throw away all the ESEA practice that they've done and start trying to practice with different weapons. It would be a bit madness to try that now. But if this was any other time and I was just giving you some key items, I think personally, some of the first ones that you should try and implement if you're heading towards that system is the ones that make certain classes more viable for to be run more of the time. So stuff like the Whip is a weird one because, as Kata says, it completely changes the rollout and like how which classes you can get to mid and stuff. So maybe not throwing that one in straight away, but certainly stuff like the Gru or absolutely the Eviction Notice. I think even the Eviction Notice could be thrown in without.
I don't even get why the Eviction Notice is banned. Like, yeah, it was so stupid when that got banned.
Yeah, I don't really understand why that was banned. But you could even allow the Gru, and you could start bringing Heavy slightly more into the game in terms of when it could be used in transition fights, or maybe run to a mid, or maybe a second even occasionally. Some of the weapons that you could try and unban are the engineer unlocks. So I think you could potentially try some of the gunslinger out, having it be the buildings now when they're built only have 50 health you can without running around and getting other ammo. It might be madness, it might be that teams decide to run it, but I kind of doubt it. As much as it gets overplayed as like an overpowered unlock, and it is just like an auto-aiming turret, so it doesn't really add much in terms of skill to the game. It's a weapon that is that does make engineer more viable for everyday use rather than just defensive play. So I think if you were to choose some key unlocks that would really immediately start to change how the game was played, it would be those ones for engineer and heavy. It would be the gunslinger and the ones that increase mobility for the heavy, like the Gru and the Whip.
Maybe I'm just like a massive homo, but I find like in matchmaking, I find the gunslinger like really fun to play with. And I think, I don't know, if people are if people are wanting to try out like 66 like proper leagues and stuff coming from matchmaking, I don't know. Like Gunslinger's
I'd be annoyed if Gunslinger wasn't in. If I'm named engineer and I wanted to try and, because it's like having a little sidearm that you can deploy, and it takes attention away from you, so the timing that you deploy it is actually, you know, it does make a difference. It's not just like you stick a sentry down and then you're fighting or whatever. So I really do think that adding the Gru and adding the Gunslinger would even be viable now to do for, possibly not for this season because we've got I-58 coming up, but you could add it. Like, it wouldn't be that bad. It would be a reasonable idea.
The Eviction Notice like has to be in though. I mean, Valve literally gave you a weapon to like bridge the gap between no heavy unlocks and the Gru.
Absolutely.
Because the Gru is probably like, I don't know how I feel about the Gru. But like, it was probably an inevitability we're gonna have that at some point, and then heavy is just gonna be everywhere. But you know, they literally gave us a weapon to have a soft transition into that in the meantime.
I'd love to see some more heavy unlocks for sure. Yeah, I think the Fist of Steel would be cool to see in there. Like, oh, for defense and offense. The sandwich,
I actually hate that weapon.
I really hate
the concept of the Fists of Steel. It's like a melee weapon that you have to close to them to actually do damage to them, so you can just use it to cross sight lines or to gain a lot of territory, and there's no skill involved,
cool.
There's no trade-off involved.
Defense
there's...
is too strong, so you bring in this thing that you can use to like break choke points, the Fists
or
of Steel.
You can use
possibly, but you can just use it
things.
For defense as well.
Yeah, yeah. Like on last you can, yeah, but you can't necessarily...
Yeah, I dislike the concept of the weapon, but I think if it actually just played out in a match, you know, it wouldn't be that bad. Like, you would see a heavy walking towards you with a huge Fist of Steel out, and you would realize immediately not to shoot at him and instead to shoot at the other people. It wouldn't be that bad in terms of how it actually played gameplay-wise, I don't think, but I think it's one of those unlocks that it was just, like, a bit of a daft concept to actually implement in a competitive game.
Talk to me, then, quickly about the sort of team debuff weapons, the Mad Milk and the Jurati. Do they have a place, or are they overpowered?
Again, I dislike the idea of them, because it's not like they just refill constantly as well. It's not like you have to go to a cabinet to refill them or you have to do something special in order to refill them. They're not like a single-use weapon. They're just on a timer, so you use it, and then a few seconds passes and you've got another one. And it makes such a huge difference to any team fight or any fight that you're taking. I mean, I think they will be in the game eventually. There's no other way that they can be balanced other than completely nerfing them to oblivion. So at some point they're going to be in the game, and they're going to be incredibly important support tools whenever they are added. I wouldn't choose to add them straight off. I think that is something that should be done down the line. You have more ways of countering it, or more ways of more things that you can use as side tools as well. So at the moment, if you allowed the Mad Milk, it would just be instant. Like, everyone would be using the Mad Milk, because there's no other good secondary slot items for Scout that are currently allowed. But further down the line, once you've allowed the other secondary slot items, then possibly if you allow Mad Milk, you'll see a bit more diversity and you won't see everybody using it. So I don't know. I think that's going to be a really tough one, actually, because they changed the game not in a great way, and there's no great way of making them work well.
Any thoughts, Kiris? We move on?
Sure. That sounds good to me.
One request there from Twitch chat is, with regards to Season 24, obvious, we're going to have a discussion about maps again, but we actually have a pretty interesting candidate in the form of CP Reckoner. Was getting some a hype in the double mix scene. Looks like a decent map. Could we see it next season?
There will be a map test cup. Like, I've only been in the forum thread once or twice, but I think it's among the candidates, and they're considering unlocks. Once again, we're compiling feedback from the Prem players, and
take a gamble though, Sonny. You know, just throw in a wild card there. Throw in the gunslinger. The logistinator.
We'll see.
Well, yeah, the flog as well. I mean, like, who's going to use the flogging competitive? It's
I wanted it last season, man.
Poop. It's, yeah, you could have added it last season, even when it was better. I mean, it's total poop tier weapon if you've got a brain to play against it. It's a little bit mad that it was banned.
Okay, so we're going to get a regular cup. I'm happy. Next on the agenda, you can take this one, Saicho, because I have to admit, I don't follow NATF2 that much, but ESEA playoffs are coming up, right? Hype it up.
They absolutely are. Yeah, it's really going to be a very good one. So the whole season, there's been four teams that were stand out above the rest. If you'd looked at the season at the beginning, you would have only picked out three of them, but the fourth team, EVL, just stormed through right at the beginning. Took some excellent upset results at the beginning of the season. Started to cool down towards the end as the rest of the team started to pick up their game, and Freutech and Street Hoops. But there's four really strong ESEA invite teams who are all taking maps off each other, all pretty competitive. And the interesting thing, although I don't like it in terms of competitive integrity, but it certainly makes it interesting, is that all of the maps are set for ESEA. Frankly, madness. But it does throw like a really weird curveball into the mix.
That's probably
all of
bullshit.
The maps are set. Like, they're all set because ESEA has no system of map veto unless it's offline. No, only online. Whenever it was at LAN, you could pick the maps. But online, it's always been set maps. It's absolute garbage for the teams playing it. Right? Did they?
Yeah, like, in the first round, like, the first map of every game would be the same.
Really? Remember, that's terrible. It was always, I never knew that.
And I just remember it always being the same. Like, it was like the first map of the series was always set or something like that, and then they...
Oh, wow.
Then they could...
Okay, I didn't realize that. But yeah, there was definitely set maps
set with it. I can't remember. So long ago that America had LANs.
What that's actually done is that it's made a really strange situation where there's where you can look at the fixture and you can like pick out maps that you think these teams will take against the other teams because they're so close and competitive, but they also have such different playstyles, some of these teams, that they're going to win like the product style game, or they're going to win the Sunshine game, or win the Metalworks game. These fringe maps, you can kind of think which way they're going to go. So it looks like it's going to be a super intense playoff. It's a pity that they don't hold it all on one weekend or whatever. It's really annoying, actually, that they spread it all out, because ESEA LAN itself used to be such a hype thing to watch. But each individual fixture, I think, is going to be fantastic this season.
I think your dishwasher is finished the cycle there, Saito.
It is.
Now that is definitely annoying, actually, that they've lost that, you know, weekend event sensation that was the ESEA LANs. Kiris, have you been following the NA season much?
Nah, ever since my hero Banny stopped being on the number one seed, I just lost faith with the American scene, to be honest.
So, what does it mean for I-58, Saito? Kiris, anyone?
What does what mean for it?
The state of the North American scene. Who are they going to be sending forth? How many teams? Are they keen to come to Europe this August?
Yeah, they are keen to come to Europe. I think, although it's not confirmed and people have just been kind of floating it out there, I really can't see a situation in which both Ronin and Froyutech don't attempt to come. Like, I really just cannot see those teams being like, oh no, fine, all right, we won't travel. So, I mean, Banny is just thirsty for victory no matter what team he's in. And Ronin, they performed at the last one. They look like they're going to perform in this playoff season. Either, I don't know, either one of their players dies or they end up coming to I-58, I think. So, maybe something falls through with funding and we don't see two North American teams, but I think it's pretty likely.
Any chance of a third NA team to wreck EU Dreams?
Maybe. It would require a lot of money, though. The community doesn't really have that much money. There aren't the sponsors there to support it. Maybe one of them will try, though. I'm not sure.
Quick segue, then, into, you know, any I-58 rumours. People are talking about Asian teams, Australian teams. Anyone actually confirmed to be coming?
I think Jasmine are, like, super set on the idea of it, as far as I can tell. Like, I actually watch more Australian TF2 now because of, like, my schedule and stuff than I do American. So I watch, like, quite a lot of the Australian streams in the morning. And they, like, I don't know, they always seem to be talking about it. Like, I don't know what their actual plans are, but they're, like, their hearts are set on it at least. Like, I don't know how practical it will be, but they've got it, like, in their sights.
I've been talking a lot with Jasmine just behind the scenes, like, about their travel. They're super intent on going and blowing this season of Oz Fortress out the water as well. They also, I'll throw you guys a bone in Twitch chat as well. They probably not going with their full roster.
Would you mind?
So they've had
not
to pick up a Merc. Hello. Do you copy? Am I lagging?
You lagged like, I don't know, halfway through. I think you were actually done lagging by the time I could speak, but
they can't go with their full roster, so they have to use a Merc. And it's I'm not going to say no.
You lagged again.
I'm not going to say any more.
Did you say
shocking? What you said in the first place. Hello? Jesus Christ, man.
Pretty excellent. You're not getting anything more out of me.
Can't get a read on this guy. He's definitely not the Real Talk TF. Oh, wait.
I heard this fucking rumor. Oh, that's so stupid.
So, just for, you know, scrubs like me who have no idea who Jasmine are, Saito, what is this roster?
Their roster for this season of Oz Fortress is Brutux on Medic. They got Paulson on Demoman. They've got Geo on Pocket. The Roman soldier is what's his name? Zaka Putty. And then their scout combo is Madness and Elmo. And all of their players are really, really good. It's like a real fresh new wave of talent from
if immunity
Australia.
Just showed up, they could crush these nerds, right?
No, I don't think so. The Jasmine are really good. If immunity was playing at the same level they were at, like, I-52, I think Jasmine would probably still win on balance.
I'm getting hyped.
They're pretty good.
I can't stop jumping up and down here, man. I'm getting excited about it.
They're all incredibly motivated, so they're going to be putting in buckets of work if they manage to get over to I-58. So I'm personally incredibly excited to see them actually perform. However, it may just be like the other times where they end up being like a really talented team, but still ended up finishing like fourth.
They have like, the scene seems so much more competitive now though. Like, you say they're like head and shoulders above, but like, I don't know. I haven't been watching the matches because just coincidences, but like I watch like a lot of the scrims where this Ego team is playing Jasmine. And it always seems like quite close, and I think that's something Immunity never had, was like close teams to practice against an actual competition in their domestic scene. But that's going to be like a huge advantage if they actually come. It'll be a huge advantage they have that Immunity never had,
certainly,
as far as
I
can tell, anyway.
Ego, I say head and shoulders above. I mean, they're beating them fairly consistently, but Ego certainly much closer than IM's competition ever were. So it's, they do absolutely have a great scrim partner there, even if they are beating them and performing better than them in the season.
Yeah, like I watched, fucking hell, what's the demo called? The good player.
Paulson,
yeah, like I watched his stream a bit, and I don't know, it might have just been the coincidence the day I watched, like they were getting kind of slammed by Ego, and you could, like, Brutalix was getting quite mad, and, you know, all this stuff, but it was like, this was like an important experience because they were then after the game like talking about how they're going to cope with being mad. And I mean, some kind of weird things were said, like Brulik said, I think I should be the only one who gets mad. And I should be allowed to be the only one who gets mad and shit like this, which is kind of weird, but I can kind of see what he means. But either way, like they're having this experience of getting wrecked and then figuring out like how do we cope with getting wrecked when it happens and how do we sort that out and come back from it, which I don't know if Immunity ever had that. I don't know if they ever got wrecked by anyone in Australia at any point.
I don't think they did.
Yeah, so
I think it's also the Ego team itself is probably going to improve over the course of the season and should be competitive with them by the end of it. But I think it's going to be Jasmine in the end who end up taking that first place spot and really performing if they do end up coming to I-58 because they're just so motivated. Every one of their players just really wants to win. And possibly because like the scene has only ever had one good team, they just really want to prove themselves as an actual good team.
Okay, you have my attention. I'm interested. One thing I must mention though is that fundraisers have been banned for I-58. Matt CV does not approve. If you want to go to LAN, you have to get a job now, just like Kudus. You want to give us some more gossip then, Sideshow? You know, about a certain major LAN event. We had a TF2 event at, where was it? Somewhere in the Nordic region there in November time. Ring any bells?
Was it that Finnish
OG,
one?
OG LAN, was it? OG LAN, yeah.
OG. Or, Winter Assembly, or whatever that other one is called.
It's on the tip of my tongue. It's like, Cream slap, or oh no,
it's something to do with sleeping, the same as insomnia, isn't it? There's like a theme running through these lands, but yeah, DreamHack Summer. So I've been talking to the guy who got us a place at DreamHack Summer. I say a place, I don't mean a place in the official rotation or official tournament, but it's like a booth in the exhibition area. They've ramped it up significantly from last time. He's just been talking to me just before this went live, actually, so this is the first hint of anything. But he said that they've brought in a load of new staff, they've upgraded since last year, they've got more money to spend on it, and they should be going for a better area. So that is all looking good for a LAN at DreamHack Summer. And there's also quite a bit of money that I managed to acquire for some cups before that. So it's all starting to look up, I think, towards that event. And then, you know, iSeries will be following it shortly.
Incredible. I heard TF2 was dead, mate.
Yeah, I heard that as well, but they added a stream view into the game or something, and now everyone can be a big streamer.
Talk to me a little bit about that. I know you're still on holiday, Sideshow, but it seemed like the stream numbers had gone up. Has the initial fanfare over the in-game stream list died down? Are people still reaping the benefits of that?
I've no idea, actually. I haven't been looking at the stream numbers. Like you said, I've been away. I've been away for the last week and a half, and haven't been keeping track of what's been happening. I know that when it first started, you know, there was quite a significant increase in at least the numbers watching the top streams. So, I don't know. We'll see. It's Kiedis. Also a hit during a down period, right? It hit right at the season, so that's a bit unfortunate.
You thinking of packing in your job, Kiedis? Maybe going full-time streamerino?
Yeah, you know, like... No, man, no way. Like, I was going to start streaming again, like, but I had to tactically wait like a week or so after the stream list so I didn't look like a sellout. And then I got hit by like a kind of brutal cold, so then I decided not to stream for ages. But you know, I'm probably going to try and take advantage of it, you know, get a holiday fund going. As soon as Sarchi comes back, exactly. But yeah. I think the initial numbers that people got from that are kind of dropping off a bit now, but I haven't really watched streams at like the peak time when kind of the streams that rack up the real numbers get going. Because I mean, that's like, if you're like a casual guy browsing a stream list and you see a stream has like 70 viewers, you're probably not that tempted. But if you see one has like 400, then that's when you start building like actual numbers off of that, because people see that and are like, oh, okay, something cool's happening here. But I haven't really been watching streams at the time when, you know, those kind of guys stream. I'm not really sure the lasting impact.
To be honest as well, I'm just going to put a bit of a downer on it all. When I first saw the numbers as well, I was actually really underwhelmed by the impact that it made. Because if you think of the amount of players actually playing TF2, and this thing is open to them, and there's like 50, 60,000 at any one time playing TF2, getting this on the corner, and the turnover to actual viewers on Twitch was really, really tiny. So maybe that'll build over time, or maybe it's just going to drop off and there's going to be basically no impact off it, but I thought it was a little underwhelming.
I'm glad at least that Valve have given us this opportunity. It was we had requested from that letter from Team Fortress TV representing the wider competitive community. So it's on you guys now, you know, tune in and watch. Hopefully, you know, all the custom HUDs are getting updated now, so that feature is actually visible on the main menu as well. But interesting to see how that one develops. I think we can start to wrap things up here. That was the last item I had on the agenda anyway. You want to talk a little bit about Gamers Assembly, Sideshow? Your reaction to the event? How did you make it out from that walled garden and underneath your bed or whatever the hell went wrong there?
Yo, I have no idea. I actually can't remember a thing. Yeah, I had a disaster of a final night there, but the whole event was actually really slick. I would definitely attend with the top team if there's another tournament there again. If they were able to acquire the same PCs, then, you know, it'd be a cinch just to fly down there and hop on, and it would all just be smooth as cake. Ilosu does a fantastic job at administrating the tournament, really gets the team captains involved, make sure everything runs smoothly. It was a really well-run LAN.
Yeah, it was a great event. I can't recommend going to a French LAN enough. They were like thinking that this could be the last one, but I mean, from my perspective at least, it was a great success. I hope that they can have another one. Maybe at Galloween or maybe Gamers Assembly next year, but definitely something to consider, Europe. Like, don't back out. For a time before this, I feel like we had a bus of people going from the UK, but it all just fizzled out. But shout out to all those people who did make the trip and all the Frenchies we met there. Like, it was just a great experience. Can't recommend it enough. Head over to France. It was pretty cheap as well, Sideshow.
Yeah, it was fairly cheap, apart from all the toll roads down. It was ridiculous.
Oh, you got wrecked with the tools.
Yeah, it was crazy. But then I went over and stayed a week in Chambéry and went snowboarding and stuff, and it was fantastic. So, well worth for me.
Do you remember what it was that got you so fucked up at LAN?
Yeah. So, I had a load of the whiskey that you had brought into the event, and then went off to find the Overwatch people, and instead found a load of Frenchies drinking in a car park, and just started doing shots of... I'm not sure what it was. I think it might have been like amaretto or something.
Amaretto.
It was something strange, and just went wild. Just like went off, jumped a fence, got into a garden, got
the
stuck.
The almonds went straight to your head.
So vodka and yogurt again.
Vodka and yogurt.
You don't remember that from a fucking DreamHack? But you convinced Flippy that it was like a classic drink. And he just fucking spurred a load of yogurt in his vodka.
Yeah, I've forgotten about that. Yeah, that's classic. English classic, the vodka and yogurt.
Okay, boys. Thanks to Sonny Black for coming in and, you know, delivering, as always, for the award show. He disappeared earlier. But credit to him. And to Saicho, Kadis, and Suyo, I'm going to leave the mic open here for any shout-outs. Nice your chance, guys.
Shout out to Drag's dad. I love his Twitter. Just made a classic just now, so everyone should follow Midnight Mick.
Oh, has he? Can you read it out?
Major congrats to Drag winning Best Roma. Fantastic first season. See, I told you it was good. Listen to Daddy.
Listen to Daddy.
That's beautiful. Say, Joe. Pull yourself together, man.
It's beautiful. I love Midnight Mick. He's just, he's got the bants in spades. Shout out to Elosu for doing a great job at administering and organizing the TFT tournament. And other helpers as well. I think Ombrak was helping out with that kind of stuff, and I'm sure there was other people behind the scenes. And Admirable and Twiggy for going there and propping up the whole event with his big egg.
Big shiny egg. Yeah, it was a great event. Serious. Shout out to everyone once again that we met there. I don't know what the next event coming up in Europe is going to be. This cup that may be being announced soon, Saicho, probably the thing in between the seasons. Sonny Black's custom map cup as well. And season 24. We didn't actually get the date then when it's starting, but I assume at the end of April, start of May.
I think he said the beginning of May to me before. But there should be a cup announced within the next few days as well, so keep your eyes open for that. It will be open to everyone. You got your chance to win fat stacks from Razor and TF Cups.
I really want to play TF2 this season as well, you know, so hit me up. This is my recruitment post. I want to make a team. That's going to be
plus five abs.
Yeah, definitely would, man. I'll play with anyone. But that's going to be it for tonight. Thanks for tuning in, guys. This was kind of short notice, but we had fun. And definitely tune in to the ESEA playoffs. Check out the schedule at teamfortress.tv/schedule. That's going to be it for tonight. Peace.